Enough. Hello. Wait till we do something. Wait till we do something. Yes, hello, everyone. Hello, everyone here and across Australia, and welcome to Supernatural Sunday, the People's Day, here at Homebush and the International Broadcast Centre. And it's the dream, once again, if you haven't joined us before. Glad to have your company. And Supernatural Sunday, the People's Day, Roy, it has an interesting beginning, doesn't it?
It does, HG. It goes all the way back to Antwerp on that...
Second Sunday. Of the games.
Of the games. HG, there would have been in excess of 63,000 people in the main stadium in Antwerp, and a ghost was seen by them all.
Is that right?
Of a nude Greek athlete smeared in pig fat.
Pig fat.
Smeared in pig fat, who picked up the discus and hurled it. Mm-hmm. As they would have done in ancient times, who hurled the javelin, who ran around the circuit, who laid himself prone before everyone and disappeared. And this was seen by all.
Did it worry them, Roy?
I think there was a lot of concern, actually. A lot of concern. It's not often you see that sort of madness, that outbreak of madness. But it became known then as Supernatural Sunday, the People's Day, and because the people saw him. It wasn't seen by any of the press, just the people. Now, speaking of the people, actually, because it is, in a way, the People's Day, you may recall, or people may recall, who were with us last night at the Ire, and the problems that this crazy, cute little guy has caused with the IOC stepping in yesterday and saying that the little guy, our favourite little fellow, the little man, wasn't allowed to be seen with any athletes at all. Mm. Now, this was brought up in a number of... Well, the news is not all bad because the Director General, this is on the administrative side of the IOC, that is Francois Carrard, was asked at a press conference today what his attitude was, and it appears as if the IOC has softened. However, the AOC looks, the attitude doesn't seem to be as generous as the IOC when it comes to our friendly little fellow, the people's mascot.
There has been a mascot that some of the Australian swimmers have been carrying in called Fatso the Wombat, and there is a suggestion that perhaps the IOC has made some ruling to ban Fatso.
I'm not aware of banning Fatso.
Given that there are official games mascots, is Fatso stealing the show? And does SOCOG have any concern about that?
No, they don't. We don't. I don't think he's stealing the show.
I'd like to ask Michael Klim and Grant Hackett what the appeal was of taking Fatso the Wombat onto the medals podium. And I'd like to ask you, Peter, whether any instructions have gone out to the Australian team as a whole to keep Fatso off the podium.
This is a matter, I think, which I'd prefer to answer rather than on the swimmers. It's a matter of some commercial sensitivity at the moment, and I would prefer not to answer the question.
Roy, while you're showing that footage, I just ducked out and had a look out the back here across towards the main stadium.
Yes.
And a mysterious apparition has just appeared above, above Stadium Australia in the shape of a ghostly presence of a fat-assed wombat.
Oh, yes!
It's back. The People's Day
the people's
is here.
The People's Day is still here.
Last night, I didn't mean to alarm, and I don't think I did alarm Australians, but I certainly alarmed visitors when I suggested the Bogong moths could turn nasty and create an enormous problem. I think, Roy, you said at the time that SOCOG was monitoring the situation. Well, let's have a look at bloody how good they have monitored the situation. We've got some footage here of last night when the lamps were lit, when there was illumination in the main stadium, and I think that you'll be shocked, as I was, when we can let a bloody look at these pictures, if you don't mind. We just want to see some moths near some flame. Is that too much to ask? I just want to see some moths circulate.
Oh, no.
Look at this. This is the travesty of what happens here. When Bogong moths get loose, they get stuck in the equipment, and all of a sudden, you get pictures of Woodies trying to deal with Bogong moths at the tennis centre. They're all over the place. Now we're back at the main stadium, here's a moth on a camera.
They're everywhere.
Here's a moth on a camera. There's moth flight. There it is. There it is, magnificent, and I think if we come down, and people are terrified, they're leaving in droves. And today, moths landed on javelins. Moth landed on javelins here. People were unafraid to pick them up. Have a look at a bloke approaching the javelin now, scared out of his mind. He has to pick one from the other rack. And I think there's got to be, dare I say it, an inquiry.
Yes, hello everyone, and welcome to the 97-kilogram Greco-Roman class at Exhibition Hall's Darling Harbour. The traditional sock down the front of the shorts has just been engaged. There it is, the sock. Yes, burglar. He's felt around. Beautiful. And this has a direct link, Roy, with the ancient games where it was done in the nude, Greco-Roman wrestling, and with oil poured on the combatants.
On the combatants. That's right. Actually, from ancient pottery, we've been able to divine that the Greeks and the Romans love doing this. They go for a feel of each other to begin with. Just a grab. If you can grab a bloke by his testicles, that's great. The other bloke's got to try and stop him grabbing him.
Here we got Ben Vincent from Australia, the Canberra-based public servant in red, and the great Erst burglar.
Ah, he's been pushed into the passivity, the passive zone, HG. And you get marks taken off you if you get pushed into there.
Mat men are a curious breed, aren't they, Roy?
They certainly are, but this Swiss tyre fitter is again finding himself in the passive area.
He's got to come back to the centre, and look at these kids, they're loving their wrestling. Mm. And doesn't it pull a big crowd, Greco-Roman?
Kids love it.
Many kids tomorrow just getting out in their undies or their swimmers and just going for
having a grope. Kids love it. They really get into it. And this tyre fitter's really showing enormous strength. As you know, HG, you're not allowed to use your legs. You can only use your legs for balance. It's all upper body. That's what it's all about. And you want to whack someone on his back and grab his tool bag.
Now, of course, burglar is as well as being a tyre fitter, he's a national hero in Switzerland.
Oh, yes, he's very big. Yeah.
Faded wherever he goes.
Yeah.
But
I think he's from the Bern canton in Switzerland.
And now Benny...
He's going down the traditional, I'm going to get on my hands and knees and swivel.
So is this just to propel the fight along, Roy?
I think so, actually, yes. He's got to poke his buttocks towards the tyre fitter, who has a look at them and examines them in the ancient way.
Oh, now we've got grappling here. Oh, and Benny Vincent's in trouble here, I think. He's going to get pinned if he doesn't watch out. But mercifully, he's going for the safety of the passivity zone. And he arrives there. And can he get just into the passivity zone? He does. But the Swiss,
has got
2 points for that. And look at these kids. Aren't they delighted? Aren't they thrilled?
I think because the public servant was pushed into the passive area, HG, he was then placed in the prone area as a result of being passive. Here now the tyre fitter's really working him over. He's really having a good look at that buttock area.
And now he's going for a reach inside the costume.
He's got a reach. He's grabbed him. He's grabbing him there around the breast area.
Roy, do you think this is fun?
Well, it's a curious sport, but you've got to remember it's very ancient.
Yes.
And we've only been able to divine the rules from the few bits of pottery that we've been able to find at archaeological digs. And so piecing it together, this appears to be the closest to what actually went on.
I think that's the high scoring for the Swiss boy there. Let's have a look and see if he gets anything for that.
The tyre fitter's going on with it. He's hurled him out.
Look at that. He gets another 3 points for that. Easy to see why. He wrestled the Canberra-based public servant, Benny Vincent from Australia, into it. Now he's got the squat.
He's got to park the buttock again towards the tyre fitter. The tyre fitter gets down and has a good look at it again and decides just quite what he's going to do with it.
And they're underway again in the 97-kilogram class. These are big lads. And, I think there should be a...
Well, see, I,
look,
I would like...
He's now gone to 11 points.
Yes.
He actually controlled him there. And there's 2 minutes... No, that's the end of the bout.
That's it.
That's the end of the bout. I thought it got moved on from there.
That's it. And personally speaking, I'd like to see the missing bits of pottery.
That's right. That's Erst Burglar goes on, winner on superiority.
The Olympic Games are going to Athens, and wouldn't it be great if they did dig up a couple of missing fragments of pottery and explain the rules a little bit more clearly?
That's right.
I mean, I think that should be... if the IOC did have some spare money from the Sydney Games, maybe that would be a worthwhile quest.
Into archaeology
and the hunt for the missing pieces of pottery. Mm. Because it is hard to work out exactly what the nature of the comp is, isn't it?
It is.
And what?
It is. Seems to me a silly sport.
Gold for Australia. The immortal words of Norman May. And once I heard them, I knew that... This is my career. This is what I had to do. Follow the goal. Phenomenal performance by four great Australian riders for the third successive Olympics. Gary's got a head for the box. From his undies down to his socks. Gary's got the head. Gary's got the head. Gary's got the best head for the box.
What have you been able to divine about the what Paris is saying about the Parekh scandal?
Oh,
have
you been Maria in touch Jose Parekh.
Yes, have you been in touch with...
Well, the response we're getting here is not dissimilar to the response Maria Jose is getting in Paris, HG. I did speak with almost François Mitterrand, but not quite. Yeah. I got as far as Guy Forget, of course, and Henri Lecomte. what she's saying now, the story is a bizarre one now, HG. It's she's claiming she was assaulted in a car park.
Mm-hmm.
She's claiming someone was in her room, in her hotel. Mm. She's claiming she had a car accident.
Car accident.
While she was here. She's claiming she was harassed in a supermarket. She's claiming that she lost her watch while she was here. That she had to pay too much for what she's described as a very ordinary café au lait and croissant. She reckons the croissants were far too buttery. And the truffles that had been imported just for her from Wagga weren't sweet enough. Now, these are the stories that are filtering through, and it's not going over terribly well with the media in Paris.
Why not?
They've given her the thumbs down.
Have they?
They think she's a lunatic.
Right. I know you're very close with Commissioner Ryan and the police in New South Wales.
I am.
I'm just wondering if there's any validity to any of these claims that she's made.
Assault in the car park, I spoke with Peter Ryan, didn't happen.
Yes.
Bloke in a room, well, someone was there changing the sheets.
Oh, yeah.
The car accident, no reportage of car accident, so we can assume it didn't happen. Harassed in a supermarket, nobody saw her in a supermarket. Lost her watch, may have done, but she could have lost it anywhere. Not less, could have been lost at Singapore, not here. I don't know, I think a café au lait and croissant, I don't think our croissants are too buttery, I think our croissants are the best in the world. The café au lait, I don't think she would have, given the state of the Australian dollar, she would have paid a very good price for it, as far as I know.
I.e. nothing.
And the truffles from Wagga, I've heard full marks.
Full marks,
they're brilliant truffles, best in the world.
Seven News with Bargain.
It's been a silver day for Australia's rowing teams, finishing second in the men's lightweight cockless fours and the men's eights. Here are the final stages of the eights race. Australia finishing behind Great Britain in an absolute thriller.
Great Britain coming up in the black boat to collect the gold medal. It will be Great Britain first. Australia gets up for second and Croatia comes in third place to take the bronze medal in the Olympic eights at Sydney 2000.
Cathy Freeman has qualified fastest for tomorrow night's women's 400 metres final after clocking 50.01 seconds in her semi-final.
Freeman's about half a metre in front. She's holding them. She's going to win. She'll be running tomorrow night.
Defending champion Michael Johnson is through to the men's 400 metres final, but he didn't win his semi-final tonight. He was upstaged by fellow American Alvin Harrison.
But it's Harrison first, Johnson second, Dwyer nearly, yes!
Γεια σου, Μπαμπατήκανη. Ήταν το άπορα τη Final Time στο Superdome σήμερα. Το θέμα τη ημέρα ήταν την Ρουσίδα Σβέλτανα Κόρκινα που κέρδισε χρυσό μετάλλιο στα Uneven Bars. Γεια σου, Μπα!
Stick it.
She sticks!
Hey!
Olympic swimming legend Dawn Fraser said this morning she thinks the world is seeing Australia in a new light.
I think the people of the world are seeing Australia in a new light.
It's all action over at the
village, isn't it?
Herb, isn't it?
Yeah. I tell you what, every time we go there, we always see Murray combing his hair. Does he do anything else? He always, can I say he always looks good with it, though?
Oh, he looks great.
Yeah.
He looks
and it's
great.
Good to see one of the legends maintaining grooming standards.
That's true. That's true. Is it good to see Herb working on his bike, on his sprocket?
And now, Bogoni.
What can he do now? What can he pull out of this? And spinning back to forward, spinning eight. And, a lot of smell. Too much smell on that landing, HG.
Yes, unfortunately, this really isn't a great routine here. He would have liked
to see
here.
Oh, he almost left skid marks there. There was so much smell.
He's broken down.
Well, that can hurt if you go down on your buttocks like that, HG. And if you leave skid, it's going to hurt.
It will every time, Roy. And it wouldn't surprise me that they don't have to get the mop and bucket out there trying to raise this brow. Igor Virovs. This may be a chance for Latvia's first gold medal in this particular event. And first medal, I think.
Well, Alexei's thrown down the gauntlet, hasn't he?
Has he thrown down the gauntlet? Let's hope Virovs can pick it up. Let's have a look at the kid in motion as we speak.
Spinning date, forward roll. Oh, that's marvellous. That's marvellous. Backwards spinning date.
Back into
tiny
the corner.
Walk into the corner because he was almost there anyway.
He put himself into the picture. Here he comes. Spinning date. Chico roll.
And he's in the corner. Oh, wide walk. He didn't need a wide walk. But anyway,
in
he's
in free position. Yeah. Goose.
And up he goes.
Beautiful.
A
little bit batted sad.
Gentle sad. Twisting around. Flat bag.
Perfect flat bag. Now he's doing hello boys.
Hello boys there. Yes.
Closes the door and half a sad.
Prone.
And he's up.
He's going to come home. Yes I'm home.
With a wide walk. With a touch of goose.
Into the corner.
And now scoring belly. Very well.
He's nailed that.
He pulled that roll.
No smell whatsoever.
He pulled that roll right out of the fire there at the end, Roy. It was a magnificent routine. He's very, very excited.
Fabulous routine.
I'm giving
him gold, HG, for Latvia. And wouldn't that be a Philip?
It'd be exactly the tonic, the Philip.
That Latvia needs.
Indeed. And make no mistake, he's picked up the gauntlet with his Chico roll here tonight that Alexei Nemov threw down.
Look at this wonderful work in the air. This bouncing back straight into...
He's the only man in the world
to do that. Now, these moves are unheard of, HG. And you can see the brooding Alexei, the furniture salesman there in the background.
While this Broadloom specialist...
Well, the Broadloom specialist from Latvia. He's looking a little bit more confident now. This bloke's on the phone. Obviously, marks are coming through and they're trying to add up.
I don't like this. You think 9 and 9 would be easy to add, wouldn't you?
Well, I'd come up with 18.
Yeah. Well, they obviously aren't. No. But you've got to say Igor Virovs.
Yes!
There's the result.
There it is.
Igor Virovs has taken the gold in the men's floor gymnastics here at the Grand Old Girl with a score of 9.812. Tremendous result there for Latvian gymnastics. That is a great result for world gymnastics, Roy.
It certainly is. It celebrates humanity, doesn't it?
Well, you saw three classical flat bags there, didn't you?
No, the flattest bags I've ever seen. So flat that I thought they must have been surgery. Surgically enhanced.
With an iron.
Just a quick one here, from Brock Cook in Atherton, HG. He just says, can you mention my name on TV? Because I'm having a bet with my mates. Well, you've won.
So now can you welcome to the dream from the Australian swimming team, silver medalists Matt Welch and Hayley Lewis. Yes. Shane Gould on the show the other night said that the Australian team makes two basic mistakes. Starts and turns are the big problem. And she said she thought that if the hands were put not like that but like that, that they'd get a lot more time through the water. Is she right?
We're not sure. I guess everyone's
probably
entitled to their own opinion.
Beautifully answered.
Do you spend much time with the Americans? Because we've noticed, I mean, it's just actually myself, a lot of them sort of get up our nose a little bit. Now, has this been the case with the team, or does the Olympic spirit triumph and you find you end up with really good friends from the United States?
I think the Australians are a bit like you guys. They do get up our noses a little bit. There seems to be certain people that seem to carry on a little bit more than others. But
what, Gary Hall Jr., that sort of thing?
No comment.
No comment?
Welcome a man who's won 4 gold medals, 3 silver and 1 bronze at 2 Olympics. Can you welcome Gary Hall Jr.?
are relationships now between the United States swimming team and the Australian swimming team?
Yeah.
Because there was a little bit of enmity there. There were a few shots fired across the bow.
Right.
How's that worked out?
It's actually worked out really well.
Good.
I think it's motivated both teams to perform better.
Did you smash them like guitars? I mean, is that the feeling amongst the team, is the neck still glued to the box? I mean, is it?
Yeah, it's a good question. Whether the guitar was officially smashed or not.
You, of course, are able to evoke a lot of interest with the antics before the races, and I think we've got some footage of you here being Mr. Muscles. I'm not sure whether we can go to that now. Here you are. You're getting ready for the I'm not quite sure. Might be the 15
metres. This endeared you to the public of Australia.
But this is. Take us through your mindset here, Gary.
Well, I'm getting ready for my race. This is the introduction of the 50. Yeah, I worked so hard for those muscles. I figured this is my one time, my one opportunity to show them off.
I was just going to change the subject massively, HG, just for a moment. Just on a very it's a bit touchy, but we should raise it. Have you tried any of our ganja, and what's it like?
That's facing the issues right here, confronted.
Yeah. Have you had any?
I have not.
No spliffs? No. Nothing?
Nothing? No, I'm reformed.
I understand that. But surely you can let your hair down now. Yes, you've got the bloody gold medal. You can put your feet up and party a little bit. At the Sports Illustrated, there must have been a bit of gear going around.
I didn't see it.
Okay, fair enough.
Did you have a conversation in the team about the hometown crowd being so vocal for Australia?
Well, what was difficult was we really got beat on that initial 4x100 freestyle relay.
We bashed you up.
Like guitars.
It was close. It was close. We took a hit, yes.
You were bent over the bonnet, we had your trousers down. And
we had the S.G. Gibson about to go right in. An enormous day at Homebush. Oh, I've only got four words to say, Roy. Gauntlet, showcase, dick pound. What's your medal analysis tonight?
The medal analysis, H.G., look. This is called A Study of Silver.
A Study of Silver. Okay, beautiful.
If we look at the analysis of silver, HG, silver medals in the games.
You might have to go more. Back here. Sorry, I made a fatal mistake.
A Study of Silver. Sorry, dick pound, right. A Study of Silver. In seventh place, Great Britain with 7 silvers. In sixth place, Germany with 8 silvers. In fifth place, Russia with 11 silvers. In equal third, France and the USA with 12 silvers each. In second place, China with 14 silvers. And on top of the silver medal tally, Australia with 19
silvers. Yes! Yes! Isn't that tremendous?
Tremendous.
Now, do you think the sponsors have, had a good time at the Sydney Games?
Look, I think they have, actually. Yes. I think they have. Look, I think it's been a sponsor's bonanza.
Not
that we could tell, because so often, actually, you and I were at Stadium Australia looking at events, etc., along with other people, and you see a lot of empty seats around the place. They're usually sponsors' seats. For some reason or other, a lot of the sponsors don't want to come to the games. No. I don't know why. Maybe the sponsors have got to look at this and actually pay people to go to the games.
Yeah, what a good idea. What a good idea.
That'd be a good idea. But in terms of shifting gear, it's been sensational. And today we saw released, HG, these little blokes, the boxing kangaroo.
I think this is rubbish.
I was trying to damn with faint praise.
Sorry, the message didn't get through.
Right.
This is the sort of thing I expect from Atlanta. The sort of thing I expect from a firm too closely connected with Coca-Cola.
Ah.
This is a very try-hard piece of merchandise.
Yeah.
Firstly, The idea is second-hand, i.e. supposedly Alan Bond invented it, for which Shocog paid him an absolute fortune for the rights to reproduce it. Secondly, what sort of message is this sending to anybody? It says it's nothing like the size, it's nothing like the bounce, it's nothing like the furry outside that I expect from a bloody boxing kangaroo with a bit of poke and grunt where it matters, Roy.
You know, you're right, because a lot of overseas people, they imagine that many kangaroos have pouches.
Yes. Is that right?
No pouch.
No.
No little wallaby or no little kangaroo poking his head out or anything like that. No, it's anatomically a disaster. The proportions are wrong. Yeah. It does nothing.
Don't think you could jump anywhere.
It hardly stands up. It just makes our... It just makes our... It laughs at our kangaroo, doesn't it? It laughs at it. Whereas...
Yes.
This little guy...
Yes,
the people have taken to their hearts. And it's not only people in Australia. Fatso the big-assed wombat talks to people of the whole world.
Yeah.
The whole world sees him as a mascot that does celebrate humanity. Mm. The little guy stands for all that's good and decent about the games. Mm. It's about people against all hardship, overcoming hardship, and pressing on with their lives. Mm. Sure, they mightn't get gold or silver or bronze every time, but they put in. He's the battleless prince. Our little guy. Battleless prince.
That flame wouldn't burn, and life would not be the same, and things wouldn't be so tame. So who's the dude that poses nude, excepting for his running shoes? Yeah, who's fat and brown, close to the ground, and bigger now than old Dick Pound? When the father went and the money spent, who will be IOC president? Well, I'll think you know why they say he's gotta go. It's Fatso.
Ian, you're looking a little bit tired. You would have appreciated the team meeting at 9 o'clock this morning.
Yeah, the team meeting was great. We're really psyched for it. It was great to get the team back together again and go through nothing, and we didn't have the opportunity to sign everyone's shirt, so that was kind of a little bit of a novelty, and that was our incentive to go to the meeting this morning.
And Misty, have you been back in the pool since the swims of last week?
No, I haven't. I'm going to stay out of the pool for a little while. I'm going to have some fun, enjoy myself.
Here's a hammer throw warming up. Have a look at him. He's trying to throw.
Yeah.
He's trying to throw in ankle deep water. And then they get the super sopper out. Yeah. They haven't thought it through. How can you mop up a deluge with an ordinary household mop?
It's old technology, isn't it?
It is. It's old technology for a new problem.
Yeah. It tells me no one had considered that there was going to be some water in the rainy season.
And here's a horse. They don't like it wet.
No. No, and nor do the riders.
No, and the horse went over to see that the rider was okay, which I thought was a nice touch.
Yeah.
We look at another horse in motion here. They're looking up there. Oh!
Oh, no.
Feet just went out from underneath the horse. Yeah. That can happen to anybody.
I know. Shocker.
And then, of course, in the stadium,
people had to pay good money. These aren't sponsors, freebies.
No, that's right.
These are real people that have to put bags on their heads.
Yeah. Bring a tarpaulin in from the boot.
There's Rupert Murdoch. He's having a great night.
He's trying to wrestle his way out of a bit of plastic. Here's somebody travelled all the way from England to realise it's just the same as
their home.
And the whole problem is that Sokog, in their wisdom, has declared the umbrella a lethal weapon.
I know. Here, look, you can get... Talk about merchandising. This is your official bloody... licensed merchandise umbrella. But you try getting one of these into Stadium Australia. You're not allowed to take them in.
Straight into jail.
Yeah. Straight over to Silverwater. Yeah,
that's right. Thrown in with that. And they won't let the, they won't even give you the key or a snip of the key.
No, it's not right.
Because you know the extraordinary thing about Kerry and Natalie, don't you? It's just how complex they are. Did you know
Kerry once fixed my transistor radio with a soldering iron and a Phillips head screwdriver.
Yeah, well, Natalie, she's Natalie, isn't she? She's a mass of contradictions. She's utterly determined, disciplined, unflappable, flighty, flexible, but you never know what she's going to do next.
Well, I know that's true too, but we wouldn't have won the bronze in Atlanta without them.
Well, one of the biggest serves coming up in the career of Kerry Potthast. And for her partner, Natalie Cook. Match point to Beattie. Out of court! They have won the gold medal!
Understand, speaking of the crowds, that Dawn Fraser gave you some advice on how to handle the crowd today. What was that advice?
Yeah, that's right. After we played Italy, we were up 12-0 in our quarterfinal match, and they came back to about 12-10, and after the game she just came up to us and said, you stopped having fun. You just simply stopped having fun. And that's what we took on for the next few games, and we just went out there, and everyone said today it looked like we were having fun, and even when we were down, we just kept smiling and went for it.
But you knew the gods were smiling when on set point in that first set when the let cord gave you the... Yeah.
That's a new rule that's only been introduced this year, and we can't believe that it gave us that first set. I mean, thank you very much.
I put it to you that one of the secrets is in here. Bondi sand.
Best sand in the world.
Now, I don't know whether this is true, but at the time there was a bit of kerfuffle about the stadium. You actually advanced, or the beach volleyball people advanced the idea that it should be played nowhere else but Bondi, because this was the best sand for beach volleyball. At the time, we suggested you should go round, say, suburban shopping centres with a boot full of Bondi sand, boot full of Manly sand, boot full of Maroubra sand, and demonstrate the difference. What is the difference?
We'll give it the sieve test.
The sieve test. Let's see if we can get it open.
It doesn't seem to stick.
Let me do that.
It doesn't seem to stick to the skin as much.
There we go. There it is.
Yeah. Okay. What is the sieve test?
And then we just go like this.
Yeah. What are we looking for here?
Oh, that's the difference.
That's it.
That's it.
That's
fantastic.
It would just stick to you. It would stick to you.
Seven News with Tamsin Lewis.
Will you be wearing a suit in the 400 metres?
It'd be pretty funny if I wore a suit. I don't think I'd look that good, but if Freeman's going to wear it, I might have to. We'll have a team suit.
Well, as long as you change it. That'd be great. Change it when the baton changes as well. That'd be fantastic.
You'd still win. That's what happened, wouldn't it?
That's right. That'd really give it to me.
Yes, welcome to this magnificent showcase for weightlifting here at Darling Harbour. 105 kilogram men's up for grabs, and here come the David Atkins tap dogs out to load the bar.
Those weights don't appear all that heavy, ain't she? They're just swiveling around like they were made of plastic.
Wagon wheels.
Yeah.
First out of the blocks, first cab off the rank, Mariusz Jędra from Poland. He's a very exciting prospect, and Roy this whole...
Yes, he stepped in the poo there very nicely. I think he does some radio work in Gdansk. He's got his own talkback show. It's called Call Me Marius. Up with problems, interesting facts and things. You know, Marius, did you know, ... You know, he's great. He's a real personality. Can't stop talking.
Hasn't Gdansk produced some marvellous lifters over the year? Lech Walesa, he can throw the weights in the air. Yeah. Almost down to time here. He's going to run out if he doesn't watch out. He's underway. He's got it. Loves to talk it up. That's his style. And there it is, 175 kilograms on the snatch. Marius Talkback King Jedra.
And that's the sort of stuff you can hear on radio in Gdansk. So, gee, he really does talk it up.
He is a real shock jock, isn't he?
He is.
Next hour, for the snatch, we've got Igor Razornov. Razornov. 105.
Yeah, they say he has his threshold of pain is extraordinary.
Yeah.
Never been hurt. It's his nickname.
His knee guards seem to be around his ankles, though.
Yeah,
I don't like
it's
that
an
quite.
Interesting
they've,
look, isn't it?
They've slipped, have they? Mm. Slipped off the area they're meant to support. Yeah. Here he goes, on the snatch. He's up.
Oh, bloody hell. Did that just whack him on the head?
The bar bit back here on Igor.
Look, he hasn't felt a thing.
Now, let's have a look at this in slow-mo. Thanks very much, Joe. Here it is.
Oh, yeah.
Tough. Now we move on to the clean and jerk. First up, Marius Jedra from Poland. An exciting lifter, as we mentioned. And the talkback king here.
The talkback king's back.
He's been taking a few calls. He's got a routine. Into the bird poo.
Into the bird poo.
One of the few lifters today who uses the poo.
Look
walks
toward,
off.
Yep. Look somewhere else.
Counts to 20.
Gathering his thoughts. Gathering his composure.
Composure. Composure here in this marvellous showcase for weightlifting. let's have a look at what he can do here. He needs to remember to do, he's trying to tell himself to pick it up.
Yeah.
Then he's got to work out.
He's very forgetful.
Bend over. He's very forgetful. He's very forgetful. Let's see what he can do here, though, Roy.
Doesn't that bloke look interesting between his legs?
I always think that's Barry Unsworth. Up he comes.
Up he comes.
Oh, talks
the
talkback
king.
The talkback king. There he is.
There he
He's
is.
Up.
He's up.
He's
one rule. He's got that up. You could put it down now if you liked.
He doesn't
put
have
it
to
down.
Hold up.
Go on. Put it down.
He's forgotten to put it down.
Put it down. What's going on?
He's actually forgotten to put the...
Put the... Oh, they've got to wave the flags to get him to put it down.
That's right. They can't... Of course, they can't speak his language, Polish, the judges.
Yeah.
And now he's cross because they made him hold it up too long. But he's just got to remember to get out there, pick it up, hold it up.
Hold it up. One, two, three.
Down. Because we're watching replay. He just forgets. He just goes...
Well, he turns around so he can't see the lights. You know, he's just a bloke holding a bar.
He's got a Mack truck on his head and he forgets to drop it.
If we look at the population of Australia, it's 19 million roughly. If we look at the population of the United States of America, 272 million. This makes the United States of America 14.3 times the size of Australia. Therefore, if Australia had the population of the USA, and you can compare here, we would have already won 171 gold, 286 silver, and 157 bronze, giving us a total of 604.
Roy, the Horsley Park Equestrian Centre was given a blast yesterday by Rodrigo Pessoa, the rowdy Spanish horse rider.
Oh, yes.
He's described the surface as shifty.
Shifty.
Yes. Now,
is that
Rod,
what he means?
I think
what, suspicious, untrustworthy.
Yes, lurking about in the dark with a couple of postcards he wants to get rid of. Oh, he's going every which way.
That's a weird track.
It is. Now, he's been throwing a leg over Balubet du Rouet, the $5 million horse. Although I had a look at it, and I
wouldn't give you two bob for
no,
it.
That's right. That's right. Roy, is there any truth that the surface, because of the recent rain in Sydney, has become a bit shifty?
Look, I wouldn't call it shifty. HG, I'd call it a wet track.
Yes, yes.
A wet track. And you know, when I was riding, you know, when I was doing equestrian and dressage, the first thing I'd do of a morning, you know, a day, you know, the events on that day, I'd go outside and I'd have a look at the bloody weather.
Yeah.
And I'd think, oh, well, rainy today. I'll phone the farrier to get him to shod my horse that was then rooting king. I'd get him to shod the king with studs.
Yes, or spikes.
Or spikes. For wet conditions. You know, no, it's not hard. The farrier comes around, he lifts the old bugger's feet up, you know, puts a couple of pins in his mouth, works that off, and tucka 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 tuck, and it's done. And click to click, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter how shifty the track is, you're tickety boo. But this ride, he just sounds like a whinging, complaining,
Euro
smug, never happy about anything, always complaining.
On the blub,
has never put in, has done nothing, is going nowhere. You know what I mean? That's a hopeless, bloody, ordinary, you said it, joke.
Now, look, Roy, two things about this is that, firstly, I agree with you. Why didn't he walk the course beforehand and realise that he had no form in the wet or on the shift, as we call it? No form. He should have got another horse out of the horse flight. There were plenty there. But I put it to you also, one of his problems was it started off fairly wet and then as the day went on, it dried out. What he needed was those spikes that you pioneered, the retractable spike.
Retractable spikes,
that could fold up into the shoe as the day dried out.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not thought it through at all.
No.
He's come here thinking that Australia will lay it on for him. He doesn't have to do anything. No thinking.
No.
It'll all be laid on, the points, the gold and everything. Yeah. He doesn't have to do anything except pilot the horse over the jump.
That's right.
Or whatever it is. Oh. I mean, it's very, very disappointing.
Oh, no, he's come out here just expecting everything on a platter. On a platter. You know, he wants his grapes peeled. He wants
bot tickled with a feather.
Yes, nymphs, young nymphs with feathers round the bot. Are you ready, Rodriguez? Feel right, sir? You know what I mean?
Listen, surely to goodness,
though. He should be bloody horsewhipped.
Horsewhipped, oh, that's a good idea. Look, I was going to say, on the other hand, do you think there is some complaint that the equestrian people haven't thought it through and maybe put in a rubble drain so as they could get rid of that water? I mean, it took about 30 inches, I think, out there, and it really wasn't quite more on the top.
It was quite, you couldn't have ridden on it.
No.
No, let's face it, it was very ordinary. I don't think the organisers had thought it through.
No.
No, I'm right with Rodriguez on this one. I mean, you can bag him, but he's got a point. Lovely bloke. Isn't he a lovely bloke? Very engaging.
Tremendous.
Once you get through that wall of hort.
That's right. Yes, the snuff box and the mole, the artificial mole and that wig. The doublet and hose and the funny gait about the place.
That's right.
No, he's a tremendous bloke and an absolute credit. Credit to the equestrian caper.
Yes, to the whole Spanish tilt.
Yes, welcome to the Aquatic Centre for the synchronised swimming qualifying rounds. And today our coverage will include a story of two nations. The first from Australia, Irina Olevsky and Naomi Young are the team. I think Irina in the front at the moment and Naomi bringing up the rear. They now come out to salute the judges and begin their routine, Roy. And their routine is a special one today.
It is, HG. It is ambitious. It begins to tell the story of the building of the Sydney Harbour Bridge. We begin here with Jack Lang being evoked and John Bradfield being evoked. And we start in Depression times when there was nothing but bleakness and the only way to get across the bridge, if you didn't have a ferry or access to a ferry, was by swimming.
And so here we see the people swimming from the north side to the south side and back again.
And wanting a bridge, linking their legs as a symbol of the linking of the two sides of the harbour, the north and the south side.
And so far everything's working out okay. And then eventually, as we see here Naomi representing the north side and Irina representing the south side, we eventually see the agreement
signed.
That's right, the bridge agreement signed. And so work could be...
Between Australia and Great Britain.
That's right, the bridge could go ahead. And here we see that agreement being shown to the people before the foundations are laid.
That's right. We should see the drilling of the foundations very soon, I think, actually.
Here they go.
There's
the drilling of the first foundation on the north side and the south side, both at the same time. And, of course, it was great fun to work on the bridge.
People loved it. There were celebrations everywhere.
People had bread.
Yes.
They had beer and they had rugby league and they had the bridge under construction. And here the work is underway with riveters
painters, people lifting things and bringing up the roadway that we accept now as part of the city of Sydney.
That's right.
Here's the work being done here with spanners and Stilsons and...
the box girders being joined together by pop rivets, by dogmen, hanging high in the sky, being watched by people, watched by the ordinary people in depression time. Sure, they had nothing to live off but a cup of hot fat poured under a bit of damper, but the bridge was being constructed. Bradfield stood proud. Jack Lang winked at people each day as he went to work. There was hope in the land once more.
And then, of course,
The completion.
After a tragic tale of, you know, loss and success and disappointment and realising that more drilling had to be done. And then success, that realising finally at last errors had been corrected and that seriousness in Parliament was producing a result for the people to see, with the bridge going up ahead of time and on budget.
That's right. And when it opened, HG, here's the opening.
Look at that. You can see De Groot coming up with the sword.
You can't you?
That was magnificent.
That was fantastic.
There it is.
There it is.
Technical. A total of 87.007. 007. Licensed to Thrill Roy.
7 News with Marsha Hines.
Olympic athlete legend Shirley Strickland repeated her call for this morning for tourists to be warned of our spiders.
Tourists need to be warned about our spiders.
What could I say? Yeah.
Have you been to other Olympic events, or have you been taking in most of the Olympics from the couch?
From the couch, because I don't really give good crowd.
No.
So.
No, that's a very diplomatic answer.
$5. Thank you very much.
And now on the dream, can you please welcome gold medal pole vaulter Stacey Dragila?
Yes! You started off goat roping, I believe. Now, how does that work?
I thought everybody would forget about that.
The news has just reached us.
You know, we're precious.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, how does it work? Well, you get a rope and you put it around the head of a goat and...
Not that cruel, no. We run into the arena with a rope in our mouth and in our back pocket.
Yes.
And we dismount our horse while it's still running and go to a goat that's staked in the middle of the arena, run down, grab the goat, flip it over, tie 3 of its legs up, throw your arms in the air for time.
Right.
That sounds like a lot of fun.
It does. Would that be a
Shall
prime,
we go try?
Would that be a prime time sport in America?
No.
Well, then pole vaulting really isn't a prime time sport in America. It's a day late sport in America. Even though you've got gold. What happens on the news services, though, in America? Do they know, or are they saying that you've got gold there yet? Or are they pretending everything's a day behind?
No, I think that's what's really hard about having the games here in Australia. Everybody wants to know the news, and they're getting it, and then they won't watch the footage. So I encourage everybody back home to watch the footage because it is exciting.
But often they could get the footage live. Now, they would have been able to see you, at what time?
Oh,
it was
gosh.
On last night. They'd have seen it when?
Well, actually,
during the afternoon.
Yeah.
It would have been fine to go
fine.
live. Why don't they do it?
What were they
because
thinking?
Because NBC are idiots.
This book, this guide to the games, Game Force 2000, go! And at the end of it, there's a little section called When the Carnival's Over. Mm-hmm. And it makes mention of, you know, that you're likely, this is apropos, something we were discussing earlier in the evening, makes mention of, you know, you've been on a terrific high, you may feel a bit flat, seek out a sympathetic ear, don't go to people who simply say, get over it. Go to someone who's shared the experience who can help you out and wallow in the problems that you have. Be kind to yourself physically. You're bound to have energy, low energy levels, having stayed awake at unusual hours. And, you know, boogie it on. It also says, rather foolishly, I think, make a photo album or scrapbook of your experience of the games. There's not one word. What disappoints me about this? There's not one word about Barry White in this, There's not one word about Sid Vicious. Mm. It's Katrina in the audience who's given us this. Mm. There's not one word about Engelbert Humperdinck here.
No.
It's disappointing, isn't it,
Paul? It is disappointing. Yeah, they haven't thought it through, have they?
No, haven't thought it through. No. If you had this, I could understand this page with a half-page ad. Barry White is coming with the Love Unlimited Orchestra. You think, you bloody beauty, game's over, Barry White, look out! It's as simple as that, Paul. Water polo is a fascinating sport because, as you point out, it's a tip of the iceberg sport. Mm. There's what you see on top of basically, men and women swimming around, having the ball on their nose, picking the ball up and throwing it into the goal, that sort of stuff. But below the surface, there's an absolutely volcanic eruption.
We can see above decks here, I
now,
see.
Well, we should warn families to look away at this stage here because a lot of bloody wrestling goes on. Yeah. Look, a lot of tugging goes on. Yep. I think that's Hungary v Croatia. Yeah. Look at that, you know. Why the referee doesn't blow that up, I don't know.
The referee's unaware.
That's right.
Here we go. Yeah, and you'll see a little more action here underneath the service. One bloke goes the tug there, and the other bloke gets him back. It's a very violent, aggressive, wonderful sport.
Yes, it is.
Isn't it?
It makes us look as though they found the missing bits of the pots.
The Greco-Roman, yes, that's right.
Yes, that's right.
That's right.
I don't think we need to dig up Italy to a depth of 200 feet anymore.
No.
All we've got to do is look at the rules of water polo. Mm. Now, what I worry about here is this fair? I mean, on top, you've obviously, the referee isn't meant to be Superman and being able to see through objects like water, as clearly as he can. He's got reflections to worry about and so on. He's also got to look at all the players, and obviously a lot of groping's going on down there while they've got the ball up the other end, all that sort of stuff. Is this fair, do you think, Roy?
I think it is fair, H.E., because, I mean, it's fair for, you know, once you, nobody gets involved with water polo unless they're, no bloke, I should specify, gets involved in water polo unless they're prepared to be tugged and to tug others. It's as simple as that. You know what you're getting into. You know what you're getting into. And H.G., I've made some of the best friends in the world. The best friend. You know, I've got out of the pool sometimes and I've looked down and there's just a bit of mince hanging out of my trousers. Out of my togs.
But you've had the time of your life, haven't you?
But I've had a great time. And, you know, I've sort of looked across and I've seen a bloke who I've got, you know, and there he is looking down this big bit of mince and he looks up and he goes, oh, you got me there. It's honestly, it's one of the great... And, you know, once you've done that with someone, you've formed a relationship.
Yeah, true.
I've made some of the best friends of my life underwater in water polo. Really get to know people. Yeah.
You're always disappointed when the game's over, aren't you?
Oh, you are.
Yeah.
Oh, you are.
Do you think?
Oh, no, it's great because it's not only dude and bag, it's backdoor as well. You know, you can really get up there.
Now, Roy, should this be acknowledged more officially in the coverage and should it be brought to the surface?
Of course, that's what people want to see.
Yeah, thanks.
They don't want to see the dull bit up top, just heads bobbing about and a bit of that and a bit of that.
Yeah, and could it be incorporated in a scoring structure?
Yes.
You know, obviously goals would be a certain things and behinds, just to use obviously an AFL cliche, could be part of it.
Yes.
Or tool tugs or whatever you call it like that. But would that become subjective then? There's 1, 2, 3, four, five, six, all that sort of stuff. Or would it be possible to, say, put your hand in the air when you felt it, be an honest system, of course, and then put the other hand in the air when you had it? You know what I mean?
Sure. I'm all for encouraging it, though, H.G. I mean, if I had my way, if I was head of the Water Polo Federation of the World...
Thank goodness you're not.
I would have each player having a suppository inserted of a varying colour, and if you came out with a bloke's suppository, you'd won.
Or... How about like in fencing, maybe a bit tricky, they're all linked up electrically speaking to a scoreboard.
Ah.
And so it's when there's a tug, up goes a point.
Bing.
That's right, you've got an idea. Opposition tug, up goes a point for them.
Yeah.
Plus the goals that they got there.
Yes.
Now you're talking.
Now you're talking. That's a sport.
It is indeed.
Oh, no, I think water polo is all going in.
Now, Pauline from Harvey Bay writes, I love your thoughts on the stress the boxing kangaroo is under on last night's program. Mm. I actually paid $7.95 for one of those, thanks Pete, at Target for my 6-year-old grandson. I got it home for 20 minutes, and after 20 minutes, one of the legs had been accidentally, in inverted commas, ripped off. Can I say, Pauline, you were bloody lucky?
Roy ripped one off in 3 seconds. So much for the stress factor. Love Fatso and ideally, you know, love to purchase him from a collection of other endangered species.
Hey, if, you know, if you do this to him...
He doesn't look bad.
No. He looks like Fatso. That's Fatso.
Steve Foley could die. The greatest plunging Australian man alive.
Fire up, will you?
I loved him leaving the board
and hit the water
like a golden Aussie sword.
Yesterday, Australia won its first diving medal since Dick Eve in 1924.
Dick Eve, couldn't he dive?
We got to... Bloody hell. I mean, talk about diving. I mean,
Diving Dick Eve, that's what they called it.
Diving Dick Eve, did they?
Or just Diving Dick. It's always diving. Dive out of bed. Dived everywhere.
Dived into the Speedos. That's why he's so bloody good. Dived into breakfast. Often he'd stand on top of the cupboard and just splash down in the Kellogg's and look.
That was Diving Dick.
Then he'd move on then. He'd be down the pool before they filled it up.
Oh, the memories.
Early in spring, just practising, doing his things like this.
There goes Diving Dick. All the best, Diving Dick.
Yes, welcome to the Aquatic Centre. We've got the women's final of the diving in the 10-metre platform. This is a jump off a three-storey building into a damp towel. First up, Natalia Tkina, and obviously injured shoulder there from Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan, yes. I think she flopped yesterday. She bashed her shoulder into the side of the pool as she was going down. She's done marvellously well to come back.
Indeed, indeed. And here we in motion now. Beautiful. Not a bad dive. Bit of splat on the bottom.
Hell of a lot of splat, HG. Far too much. A bit of DB, to be frank.
DB, yes. Have a look at it in replay.
Yeah, she's all wonky. She's all over the place. She straightens out a little bit towards the end, but she hasn't really come out of the dive, out of the spin before she hits the water. She's only starting to come out of it, and that's why you get so much splat. So that's why it's been marked down.
Rebecca Gilmore, the Australian now, with a degree of difficulty of 3.
Yeah.
And here she goes. Oh, she's in trouble. He's a dog's breakfast boy. That's a DB with V.
Yes, that's a DB with PhD, with pike, with a couple of pike and a mullet and a flathead thrown in, I think you'd have to say. Unfortunately, she...
Too short.
Too short, right from the off. Didn't come out of it in time and was lucky to survive it, to be frank.
Now, of course, we've got from the USA... As we see Gilmore scores on screen now, USA, Laura Wilkinson, the whistle blows, and Laura's on her way. Degree of difficulty 3.1. Yeah. She's going for a handstand with a closed door at the top.
I think she was a gymnast, HG, before she started.
She certainly has all the moves of the gymnast.
Yes, well, to open with a Dutch wink is certainly going to impress the judges.
Your inverted wink.
Yeah.
Laura Wilkinson on her way. Okay. Look at
that. Oh, that's a lovely dive.
That has got set. Look, I put it to you, Roy, that's thrown down a gauntlet. It's thrown down an absolute glove as we watch in replay. Now, this dive is throwing down the gauntlet to China and Canada.
Chinese,
and I believe Sydney has run out of gloves, Roy. Look, all the gauntlets are in the pool.
I know there's a bloody big gauntlet thrown down there. You're right. Can the Chinese pick up that gauntlet, I wonder?
Anne Monmini. Beautiful dive.
Oh, that's a lovely dive.
The Canadian contingent like that.
Oh, that's a beautiful dive, HG. Oh, bloody hell, that was a cracker, wouldn't it? You'd almost give that full marks, wouldn't you? What was wrong with this? I can't see anything wrong with this. It's beautiful off the platform. It's absolutely symmetrical. She comes out perfectly, 5 metres out.
Yes, look at that. You really have to ask the judges why they didn't give it.
Why didn't they give it 10? That was worth 10.
Yes, and so now we have...
Oh, no, that was a bloody, absolute bloody cracker.
Li Na from China. On the planks at the moment.
Well, she's got to pick up the gauntlet now that's been thrown down by the Canadians and the Americans.
She's got to slip her hand right inside the glove and raise it out of the water
as she
comes back up.
Let's see if she can.
I mean, she's got a five-finger exercise here, Roy. She goes into Li Na. There's nothing wrong with that. She's got it right inside there and including the inner as well, Roy.
Yeah, yep, she's taken that gauntlet and shoved it right up him, hasn't she? That's
Look
a perfect
that.
Dive.
That is brilliant.
That's an absolute bloody cracker again. No, yes. Why didn't that get 10 again?
You know, you just got to ask yourself, are they seeing the same competition? Montminy up again, and again, a gymnastic start.
Yeah, high degree of difficulty this HG. Difficulty closing the door there, but she's right by the looks.
She's on her way. Have a look at this. Whoa, no, a little bit of DB at the bottom.
A hint of breakfast there, HG, from the dog, for sure.
She'd be disappointed with that. Let's have a look on replays that go down
with the
camera.
Did she come out too slow? Yes, she was just coming out of it.
Just slightly off the vertical.
Yeah, she'd be disappointed with that.
And next up...
Nobody likes doing a dog's breakfast, darling, but you did one.
And now we've got, Laura Wilkinson, at the moment a competition leader who seems to be stealing...
Well, she's got to throw down the gauntlet again, hasn't she? HG, she's thrown down a series of gauntlets tonight.
She's thrown down a golden gauntlet, Roy. This is sneaking under the guard as she's on her way. Let's have a look.
That's good enough, I think. That's good enough. That's gold. Almost good enough for gold.
And so...
Oh, yeah, that's got to be an 8.85, something like that. That might get a gold, HG.
Look at that. That's magnificent diving. And she's picked up that gauntlet, hasn't she?
She has.
And shoved it right up the Chinese and Canadian tilt here. And there is a wonderful score there. And let's go and have a look at the final placings in the women's 10-metre platform. And there it is. Laura Wilkinson first, Li Na of China second, and Montminy third from Canada. Yes. Marvellous day, Roy.
And China second and fourth. They won't be happy with that.
Message, this comes from Paul Noon of the ACT. He says, I'm a bit worried about the number of gauntlets lying around Homebush. If you were to believe Dennis Cometti, everyone is throwing down the gauntlet. I did notice a fair few gauntlets being thrown down. Yeah.
Roy, what have you got there medals-wise?
Oh, medals-wise, actually. Analysis. Yes, analysis. We're calling it putting it in perspective, HG. Mm. Putting it in perspective. The population of the world is 6 billion. Mm-hmm. The population of Australia is 19 million. Mm-hmm. Therefore, Australia has 0.317% of the population of the world. The total medals awarded so far in Sydney, 2,586. The total Australian medals, 44. Mm. Therefore, Australia has been awarded 7.508% of all medals, which is 24 times more medals than we should have earned.
Wow.
So we are...
Wow.
So we are 24 times the best country in the world.
Isn't that incredible?
Isn't that incredible?
Yeah. There are some sick minds out there, some really weird people. And today, here at the Dream Dome, we got this horrible, horrible note that sent a chill through us all. It simply says, a dream pin or the wombat gets it. I hope you can see that there. A dream pin. The wombat gets it. Roy, what have the police done in response to us receiving this cryptic note?
Yeah, well, look, the management here at the Olympic Games, and indeed SOBO, have been in touch with Commissioner Peter Ryan because our little man, the Battler's Prince...
The Battler's Prince.
He's been stolen.
Mm. Kidnapped, I think.
He's been kidnapped. So the police are doing all they can, and we'll be keeping you abreast of. I mean, if we learn of something, unlike NBC, you'll find out about it immediately. we do have an identical picture of Fatso HG.
In case people haven't seen him,
that's him.
That's the best the police artist could do.
If anyone sees the Battler's Prince, in a bag, in a boot somewhere, that's our little guy. And just bring him home if you wouldn't mind, because he lives here and we all love him and we're missing him.
What's the most unusual thing you've seen in a bag?
Marital tools, things like that. Yeah. Vibrators?
What do you think people are going to do with those out here?
I would not have a clue.
Arguably Australia's finest sporting mind, David Campese, former rugby union great, has come out and sort of basically bagged the Olympics as having too many sports in it. He thinks that it should be slimmed down to, wait for it, athletics, gymnastics, rowing and swimming.
I'm not sure on what criteria, but of course make way for rugby union to be included. No surprises there. Is he right? Do you agree with the Campo position that there's too much sport in the Olympic Games and it should be sort of sculpted into this four sports plus rugby union sort of package?
Well, you've got to look at David Campese and realise that, for a start, he's an idiot.
That often eludes me.
I think that's the...
I have to write that on a bit of paper. Whenever I see... Like, here's the article in the paper here, and I've got to remember to draw a line down the bottom right.
You've got to remember.
This is an idiot.
Seven News with Billie Jean King.
Seven network executives have praised the work of the New South Wales Police Force and Commissioner Peter Ryan in particular after the dramatic arrest tonight of a man, can you believe it, who attempted to kidnap Fatso, the big arsed wombat. Oh, shame, shame.
He's back.
Aww. Have you been enjoying your games, Billie Jean?
Well... You are the highlight of my games.
Yes.
You are my hero.
She's saying this
well, the games have been pretty ordinary.
No,
then,
I do not. Believe me, I do not say that ever to anyone
right.
on any show.
Right.
Anyway, I come over here, and all I see is the tennis courts in the hotel, right?
Right.
So every night I turn on the telly, and it's what, I don't know.
Why don't you see some of the other sports?
You must
know,
be joking, because I'm working.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, what?
Yes, of course you're on air all the time.
No,
with NBC, does it get back? I mean, does anyone ever see it?
A little late.
A little late.
A little late, but they see it.
Go to bed, mate.
Thank you. Dude, they're up way beyond their bedtime,
those bedtime.
Legends. So we move on to Hearts of Gold.
We have stability and the facilities, plus the administrative skills.
The Sydney Olympics are here with us.
Go, you good thing. What a gathering. Go, you good thing. Go.
Protect the earth with all your worth. Exercise damage control.
The greatest of games this century in the land we love, Australia.
Share the spirit of the games, everyone.
You're on fire. You're on fire.
Here come the Australians.
Cheer for your athletes, no matter where you if you're near or far.
For the turn of the century, we'll make history.
You don't like blues, you grin like
that. It's gold, 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 Australia. Gold, gold, gold.
With pride and joy we hail ya. So shine.
So hard to make your choice, but that's up to you, Australia.
Yep.
You have to pick.
It's in your hands.
One of those, and voting.
There are no other alternatives. That's it. That's your lot. It's one of those.
Two Aussies. Two rackets. Two mates. Two great mates. Two great Australians.
You ready? Ready as I'll ever be.
The Woodies. Mark Woodford and Todd Woodbridge. Two champions.
Brilliant tennis from the Australians.
Representing Australia, Todd Woodbridge and Mark Woodford.
I will go the distance and
existence, I will lay my soul on the line. When the world is over and the heart has spoken, if I give my all, I will shine.
Thanks, Woodies. Thanks for the memories. Thanks for being Aussies. Aussie dreamers, fulfilling a dream for the dream.
Ladies and gentlemen, can you welcome the silver medalist in tennis in the 2000 Games, the Woodies! I've got to say this right from the top, you can't leave it here. I know you've said this is your last match, but, you know, I think you broke many people's hearts with the effort today, especially as it finished. And you must feel as though there's unfinished business now, especially with a couple of no-name Canadians who came from nowhere to win the gold.
You go. You're leaving, not me.
What do you think? Complacency? There might have been a complacency there, HG.
What, on behalf of the Woodies?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
No,
Roy.
I don't think so.
I don't think so at all. I think they wanted to go out on a high.
Yes.
They were just met by a better combination on the day.
On the day.
But I'm trying to suggest that they should push on now.
I know. Well, what's the story? What's the story? It's up to you, Mark. I mean,
it's totally up to Mark.
It's up to Mark.
Keep rocking.
Because
I'm an old man. There's no way that I can.
But what are you going to do? Stand at the net with a bucket of balls and some kids whacking them at you?
As the advert says, we're totally bloody useless on our own. But put us together, it's synergy.
Look, couldn't you reduce it just to four tilts?
Yeah.
Four doubles teats.
Four slams.
Four slams. You know, yeah. Australian Open. You know, holiday. Fun,
see the
Melbourne,
folks.
Adelaide.
Yeah, that's right.
It, yep.
Then you move on to what would it be? French Open,
yep.
Wimbledon, then back home to the US Open. You know, how does that sound? Just four tilts.
Sounds good in the commentary booth for him right now.
Oh, right.
What do you think?
Oh, is that a possibility?
I'm going to be behind that desk.
Oh, you're coming over this side of the table?
I'll be on that side. I'll be passing comments on all of them, including him.
Right.
I noticed the Prime Minister was there. Did that put you off at all?
No, well, actually... He's been winning gold all over the place.
That's right.
But the difficulty was...
I actually felt quite good when I saw him because I've seen how many golds he's been able to win while the Games has been on.
I understand his office is saying, though, that it's just an accident that he bobs in for the gold. He goes to a lot of events and then I thought, oh, hello, the Woodies are in trouble here.
Is there a palpable team spirit over there in the village? I mean, were you part of that? Are you staying in the village?
This was smoked, wasn't it?
Yes. Oh, in part it was smoked. Yes. Now, you might be able to tell us here. Is the
feud on
between Mark
appearance
and
of Pat Rafter on the show? Has that calmed it down
a lot? Is that still there, do you think?
I think Paddy's watching at the waterfront.
Well, he would be.
He'd be very keen.
He would be. Is it still? I mean, are they talking, those two?
Yes. Well, I was rooming with the poo this week.
Were you rooming with the poo?
I was rooming with the poo.
Right, how was that?
It was very cold for the first few days. There wasn't too much conversation going back and forth between Pat and Leighton, but I think once they saw that Todd and I were talking to Flip, you know, quite often, that everything thawed out, and Flip just started to. He really eased into it. He had a great time in the end. So it all came to a head when the whole team actually sat down one night and watched Roy and HG. And we all sat. We watched you two guys talking about all of us.
Right.
And it was soothing for all of us to see what we thought about us all.
We thought that they should have both come in to smoke it together. They should have come in and
they should have come in and smoked together. That's what we wanted.
That's what we told them. But did they listen to us?
No, because the feud's still on.
That's right. It's still going.
Yeah.
It's tremendous this could come in after the win, and good luck. And
we didn't win today.
No, well, I mean, the win...
I think silver's pretty bloody good. Yeah. What do you mean you didn't win?
You won
a medal at the Olympic Games.
Yeah, sorry.
You won gold last time, and this time you've got silver.
It's still a win. I said today, whether we won or lost that, it was going to be a great day or a bloody great day, and
it was still a great day.
Meeting new people, seeing new things.
How is it different?
We don't walk as much. There's not as many open stores. Different language.
This comes from Damien of Newcastle. I see big fat Aussie kiddies all over the place, but we never have anyone in the big fat events. Why aren't we finding... It's a cruel bloody message, well, but a serious one. No, and he's thought about it. Why aren't we finding these big fat Aussie kiddies and training them up, fattening them up for all the big fat events, i.e. heavyweight lifting and heavyweight boxing, wrestling and judo? From your coverage, I've seen big fat girls and boys from other countries. Where are our big fat Aussies? I know we have them. I've seen them.
Yes, welcome to Greco-Roman Wrestling, the 130-kilogram class, a fatty Bakia out now fiddling with himself. Here he goes down, doing the dog. And then he goes for the flute.
For the flute.
And
oh,
mercifully...
No, I didn't mean that. Oh, yes, I did.
Didn't call time, but that doesn't prevent him from getting right down there as well. And it's a beautiful style. You know, people say the World Wrestling Federation has it all over Greco-Roman. I don't, as Yuri gets a point there. Yeah. I think that this is really wrestling as its finest as Yuri tries to push his head through to China and finds Faith Bakia in the road, and so gives up that ploy, and then they have to break and come back to the middle. Yuri now has moved on to 3 points, yes. Totally outclassing his opponent at the moment, Fatia. But isn't this beautiful showcase for Greco-Roman wrestling?
It's one of the best showcases in the world, HG. Now, I think Fatty... And Fatty's trying to put Yuri on his back. I mean, the idea is to get your opponent on his back. You know, easy to say, of course. But they're masters of the mat. They always know where the mat is and always go to the mat belly down, which makes it difficult then for your opponent to roll you over.
As Yuri reaches inside the costume, the referee says break. I was looking at the net side... the Thracian goblet net side, as I think Fatty now goes the grope on Yuri.
Oh, he looks good.
And the rules are there as taken off the Thracian goblet. And it's a very, very exciting read. Of course, it's in ancient script, and I have a bit of trouble with my ancient Greek. But the bits that are missing seem to hold...
Interesting bits, aren't they? They hold the key, don't they? The bits that are missing are the rules. All we have is images of blokes in similar poses to these, and we've got to try and work out through gestalt as to what the meanings might have been. The handkerchief tucked in, the not allowed to use your legs, the
doing the dog,
the having a sniff, the
groping. There he's, oh, he's held up again. Oh, he's on the way again. Oh, look at this. Oh!
Well, he matted him completely. Once a bloke's gone, Matt, it's very hard to
do
get
anything
underneath
with
and roll him over, yeah.
But that's the art that a young Fatia Bakia from Turkey has to do now, and he's been resisted by Yuri from Israel. Yuri's got a good grasp of that mat. He's a tremendous mat man. Yeah. You know, I've seen a 3-ton truck try and drag him off a mat, but he had no success.
Way. No way.
No success.
And they're working very hard, actually. We might have to stop soon to towel off, because you're not allowed to have any sweat on you whatsoever.
Is that a rule on the Thracian goblet, or is that a modern addition to the sport?
No, there is a piece of goblet that has a man being wiped. And just divining from that... Oh, hang on. We might have to stop wipe. Yeah, he's got a wipe. I think that's the sign for a wipe. Yeah.
No, they're going to wrestle on and he's going to do
the
dog.
Oh, they're wrestling on? Oh, OK. He's got to do the dog. OK. And where did he go? The rope?
No.
Oh, he pushed him down. He's grabbing his head.
And they're trying to pull it off. Because they can't think without their heads, you know.
No, it's true.
And these bigger men are fantastic, aren't they? And look how nimble they are.
Yeah.
I mean, people say that 130-plus kilograms.
Ooh, nimble. Oh, there's a bit of a throw.
This is the towel here, indicating a towel off
towel
top.
Off. Which is a bit of a shame for Yuri, because he really had the drop on Fatty, it seemed to me, there.
Oh, yeah, it was tactical there. But I think Yuri knows he's got him under control.
Yeah. Herodotus spoke of the original Greco-Roman wrestling, HG, which was just the use of the head. I think the idea was to wedge your head as far as possible. until either...
He said
either
uncle.
Or you suffocated. Could go for hours. True. There is talk of bringing it back, too.
That's a big sport. Now, Roy, today there was a tragic scene as Jane Saville approached the main stadium in the 20-kilometre women's walk. I think we've got some footage of her cock-a-hoop that she's in this position, i.e. in the lead.
She was in the lead, coming first, coming into the stadium.
With a bit of a daylight between her and the second-place competitor.
Yes.
And then we'll see what happens next. And walking is such a technical sport.
Oh, it's all technical, isn't
it? It is so technical.
Yeah.
And if we get the next shot, I think here's the problem here, is an official holds the paddle pop bat up to her, or the ping pong bat up to her, and disqualifies her with victory in sight,
Roy. That's right.
Victory in sight in that matter.
Her dream is shattered.
Absolutely. Jane is distraught, understandably. She doesn't know what's going on, and then no one comes to help her, of course, and maybe there should be something that, you know, counselling and all that sort of stuff cut in
there.
And help with a cup of tea.
But if we have a look, what happened a few days ago when the blokes were walking, let's have a look at the blokes walking. Now, these blokes, one was disqualified, but the other one, they're all running.
Both heels off the ground.
They're running.
And we haven't doctored that footage. One eye onto Roy.
They're running,
exactly.
And some of them won medals.
Yes, look at that. They're running.
They're
everyone
just
running.
Running.
Look, both
There's
heels off the ground.
There's going to be an inquiry. Where's Dick Pound now?
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Our Jane is gutted.
Yes.
And yet these other cheats, making technical mistakes, not walking, but running. They get silver and gold and bronze and accolades and heroes, dreams fulfilled.
It's a cruel world,
isn't
it?
I'm furious.
Yes. Roy, what do they have to do? Can you demonstrate, maybe with your hands, exactly what's meant to go on?
Well, look, walking. I've only got volley OCs on.
Yes.
Walking. One foot has to... One heel must be on the ground at all times.
Yes.
Simple as that.
Yes.
Simple as that.
Yes.
If you have both feet off the ground, then it's running.
I know.
That's not terribly technical by way of demonstration because the table's a bit rickety and I don't want to bugger it up for Bruce.
Yes, yes. I take your point entirely. Dick Pound, there's got to be an inquiry. Jacques Rogg, Kevin Gosper, they've got to get together, perform a tribunal, call people in and stand them on the spot. Show them the pictures and say, listen here, Sonny Jim, have a look at yourself here. What do you think going on here? I think you're running, Sonny Jim. What are you looking at? You're looking at three blokes who know what's going on and you don't. Now get your kit bag and sling your hook out of the village, out of Sydney, out of the Olympics, and learn to walk on the way home, if you don't mind, Sonny Jim, before you show up in Athens in 2004. Right.
And can I say, I hate to have spoiled that illusion. A lot of people think that, you know, when you're whatever's up top marries what's down below.
Oh.
You know, I'm sorry about that, but it's same with Bruce, same with Sandy. I mean, they just wear rubbish downstairs, don't they?
No, often they're nude. They're often nude downstairs.
Nude?
Yes, they are.
On Throbbing Thursday?
Throbbing Thursday. I mean, Sandy was in here causing all sorts of problems for the makeup people.
What, during the...
during the ad break.
During the ad break?
Yeah. Well, they had enormous problems. You know, and the table came up a little bit off the ground, you know, floated around, wiggled a bit. You know, all that sort of stuff was going on. Throbbing Thursday.
Idea.
Oh, no, you... I mean, at least you remembered to put your trousers on, which is more than I can say for sure.
Paul Bruce.
Around here.
I was all right for a while, till I saw you start.
Sorry.
I knew I was gone when that final was on. And I stopped when he whispered, go. It was Sandy on.
Can you please welcome Tatiana Grigorieva, silver medal pole vaultist.
What drew you to the pole in the first place?
What
drew you to to vaulting?
He asks complex questions at times.
It's a simple bloody question.
Well, we've been following that story about the vault being 5 centimetres. You established there was, you know, claimed it was 5 centimetres too high a little while ago, when in actual fact it was 5 centimetres too low. But
made it even harder.
It did. It made it bloody hard, and it upset some of the great the great athletes who are here in that competition, including Svetlana Khachina. Now, Nellie Kim from the International Federation has posted on her website an apology, saying obviously she's disappointed that this happened. She doesn't know who to blame, but she suspects Dick Pound may have had a hand in it. She feels as though it's easy to understand why athletes in particular, gymnasts in particular, feel as though their competition's been ruined. Now, this is one of the disappointing aspects of the web, is that you feel as though you can post these notices on the web and everything is forgiven, everything's absolved. Well, not in the dream, it's not. Not in the dream, it's not by a long bloody shot. It's not nearly good enough. It's not nearly good enough to simply put something on the World Wide Web saying, I'm sorry, I put it behind me, we move on. Oh, no, she's got to be called to account. Otherwise, people will be getting away with murder and simply putting a sign on the web, sorry, I had to murder Dick Pound. Something came over me. I'm sorry to the Olympic movement. I'll put it behind me, we just move on. I mean... As you know, I had to rob the Bronte, the Commonwealth Bank in Bronte recently, and I put a I put a note up and explained. That's right, had to do it, and mercifully, every court in the land accepted my website apology is right. It's not nearly good enough, though, is it, Roy?
No, it isn't. I think there has to be public accountability and public grilling. I think the person involved.
Well, the people involved.
It might have been more than one. Yes, it might have been. See, this we don't know, but they should be named. And they should be forced to stand outside Stadium Australia for a start with a sign saying, idiot. Then a further sign, ask me about it. And so 110,000 people for a start, and this would be filmed on cable or free to air, live. You could have 24 hours of them just being grilled. 110,000 people say, oh, you're an idiot, mate.
Yeah.
Why? Tell us about it. Oh, I got the tape wrong, you know, I thought it was that. Oh, it was you, was it?
Yeah.
That would make them publicly accountable, I think. They should be able to stand out there from whenever it happened, say 5 days ago, I don't know, these things disappear off the back of the truck of your mind, but let's say it was 5 days ago, they should be there until the end of the games.
Yes, absolutely right, Roy, and I think that's good because I think that's the great thing about the Olympic Games, it's such a democratic movement. Isn't it?
Oh, it is. It's the most democratic movement in the world.
Yes, that's right. And so getting the people involved in that sort of process, I think it's first class, Roy. First class.
People might decide they might want to take it further.
Like boot them up the date.
Like boot them up the date.
Yeah, that's right. Here's one to go on with you.
Yeah, that's right. That's
not good.
And others might agree. Yeah, let's do this with them.
Yeah, that's right.
Why don't we do this? Then you get an idea happening. You know, next thing you know, they're dragged into the stadium with 110,000 people.
Beaten to death with pole vault
sticks. That's right. Oh, no, they'd get it right next time.
They certainly would.
And you only have to make an example of one or two of them.
One or two. You know, we've had a tremendous competition on Sydney Harbour, but it hasn't always been the most exciting form of sport. And I believe you and I, through the dream and through the dream people, could, you know, liven it up a bit.
Well, it's dull, isn't it?
Well... Yeah,
I think it's dull.
Yeah, now that you've put it to me like that, you're right. Let's have a look a little bit here. I think this is a difficult day when the wind just gave up.
This is an exciting finish.
Yeah, have a look at this.
Here we go. Is he going to break the record? Well, he hasn't, no.
That spinnaker's been held aloft by the bloke's collective breath.
Yeah, here's the Netherlands really bringing it home. Look at this. And are they working, those blokes? Are they fit? Hey, look at that, a couple of bloody Dutch bludgers sitting there doing nothing.
Oh, look at this, the wind gives out.
No! Oh, God, get home, get there.
There they go.
Oh, there's the victory celebration.
Look.
You better put the gear away, Dan.
And I think these things should be taken on board by the Olympics because I believe you could liven it up. If you dressed, as you alluded to earlier, a couple of them with, you know, sort of bandanas and, you know, black patches over their eye and a couple of darkened teeth.
A cutlass
each. Somebody with a peg leg. You'd have to obviously have one peg leg on every boat. And when they came near each other, you were able to swipe at them with your sword. Or you had a hook, you know, like, you know, Captain Hook. You could clobber a hole in the boat. And then I think you'd see something. Get on board cameras and then add to it a sense of Greco-Roman wrestling, where you could board the other boat.
The very old style.
The very old style, where you could board the boat and get people in these locks like this. And I think you'd have a sport.
No, you would.
You would.
Oh, you would. There's something missing. Look, it's an attitude problem. I mean, for a start, the boat should be given names like the Bastard.
Yeah, that's right.
Here comes the Aussie Bastard.
That's right.
You know, up against the Mongrel.
Yeah. The Norwegian Mongrel.
The Norwegian Mongrel making a go at the Bastard.
Yeah.
Perhaps ramming devices.
I reckon that's a good idea.
A really sharp steel spike.
Yeah. Stick it out the front.
Stick it out the front and you can really warm it up.
Put a hole through them.
Maybe someone lashed to the mizzenmast.
Oh. Who had to be cut free. For bonus points.
Yes. Yes.
And employ some of the techniques, I think, that Russell Crowe... I mean, of course, the film in Gladiator had nothing to do with history, but there's a lot of good things there. I'm wondering if you could let a couple of tigers loose out there somehow. Sort of run.
What,
you know,
swimming tigers?
Well,
especially trained at Taronga Park.
How about...
Why not just release every animal from Taronga Park and see what happens? Sail through that!
Yeah, that's right. How about on those buys, you had a tiger there, and for extra points, you had to get a copy of Aussie Gold off the buoy before the tiger got you.
Well, I think all these ideas are good. And I hope Mr. Pound is listening.
Yes.
Yes, hello everyone, and welcome to the introduction agency that is Taekwondo, where round three in the 68 kilogram for men class, we've got Carlo Massimino in red and Francisco Zos in blue as we get underway in round three. The scores, as you can see, Spain one up on Australia's tilt here from Massimino. Roy, how are you seeing the bout?
Well, oh, he gave him a good one up the date there, AC. The Australian seems to be more aggressive, I think, and he's been softening up the Spaniard by, you know, kicking him in areas that aren't strictly speaking worth any points. He's given him four or five up the date.
A couple of the Cruets.
We saw a couple of beauties to the Cruets, and he's been working on his knee. Kicking his knee.
The knee seems to be the weak spot, the Achilles heel, if I can coin a phrase, of the Spanish boy Zas. And Roy, it's a real meet and greet night.
He's got
him now. Yes. Can't get any points for that, but if he can kill the opponent through the knee, and I've seen many a great fighter go down as we watch in replay, a clash of knees there.
It was just a legitimate block, wasn't it?
Zos, unfortunately, copped the worst of it. It could have been easily the other way around. And now, I don't know if this is actually strictly within the rules of the Olympic Games, that people can come out and spray can Mortine all over a bloke, even though he's not complaining of flies.
Yeah, I don't like it. I think you just, if you can't get up, it's over.
Exactly. If you can't get up on your note, I mean, that's a deliberate aid to that bloke being able to get back up.
Yeah.
That Spanish kid. Look at him now. He's bouncing around on a pogo stick out there, Roy. Yeah. Oh, no. I'm right offside.
Oh, there goes one up the date again.
He gave him one right up the date there. And unfortunately, can't get any score because, as we pointed out earlier in the week, you have to hit these
blue and red dots
on the fighter's gear.
Or the head.
Or the head, yes. He went up high there. And he goes again, and he thinks he's got a point. But unfortunately, the judges don't see it this way. Now, the Massimino tilt is 1 point down, Roy.
Yep. And, you know, I'd like to see one of those blue and red things on the date because I think there'll be a lot of heavy scoring. I mean, people want to see more scores.
They do. That's what's wrong with this, if anything. I mean, I love it.
I love it, too.
And now they're getting to say hello and just working with the phone numbers there. In they come, and the Iranian referee knows his taekwondo and he's really encouraging the Massimino tilt to get the foot to the accelerator and really move on. Roy, would you describe this as a giant versus the beanstalk bout?
Well, I think it is. I'm just trying to work out who's the beanstalk here. Probably Massimino would be the beanstalk, and we'll call Zas the giant. Yeah.
And so the beanstalk now one behind on the scoreboard.
Yeah, and he's running out of time too. HG.
He's down into the last minute.
He's dated him three or four times. He's kicked him in the knee a few.
More date there.
I think.
And of course,
Australian like that. Yes,
he's squared the board now.
He's on attack.
Yes, even though he took one to the date, no score there. And I think the Massimino tilt is right on track here because if it's like this now, and there's a bit of a crunch there.
Oh, he grabbed him there and booted him up to date.
If the score stops like this in 41 seconds, then it'll be down to artistic impressions from the referee, and that's always very, very exciting, that part of the
fight. That's the
best
bit.
Once the exchange of addresses, then the referee comes into play as the sort of postmaster general.
That got there, I think, did it?
Yes! He's got to get one back now.
The Spaniard's ahead.
Massimino, the Spaniard ahead by 1 point. Zos! Yeah. Zos, yes. And, of course, Massimino saying, well, come on, boy.
Well, now we're going to... Oh, that might have got him back. No. Yes, he's back.
There's
in
the
it.
Point. They're all locked up. There's 8 seconds to go. Massimino and Zas. It's coming down to this. It's going to be down to the referee, I think, Roy. A quick flurry of clicks at the end of the 68-kilogram bout. And I think that's it. Time's up. Wow. 3 points each. How are you seeing it now, Roy?
Well, I think the judge has got to go on superiority here. What we call superiority, or who was the most attractive, who did the more date kicks.
He's going to check his notebook.
I think it's going to go to Massimino, HG. I'd go with the Australian here. He was clearly the aggressor and got more date kicks in.
Yes, it's a pity. Date
by about 5-1.
5-1 on the date. The Zos boy will have a very sore ring as we see now. Yes!
Yes!
The Australian tilt moves on. Carlo Massimino in the 68-kilogram class moves on to another round, and it's a tremendous result for Taekwondo, especially after Lauren Burns got gold the other night,
yes,
Roy. Could we
it.
See another medal for Massimino and the Australian tilt here in Taekwondo?
Well, I'd like to think so, AC. What a great night. What a great event.
Gentlemen. Yeah,
great
I just
event.
Love it.
Oh, kids are into it. Everyone's gone Taekwondo crazy, and you can understand why. Look at this. A proud Australian and a winner.
I was going to say, the one thing I think is that they fight a lot in one day.
Mm. You know, the
Too much, five or so bouts. I mean, if I think Carlo Massimino had time to collect his thoughts and maybe some of the headache had gone down, I think it would have been a different Taekwondo player, if that's the term, tomorrow.
Well, if your back door's kicked in, you need a bit of time to recover. It's always been my experience. You know, you got to rehinge and
You got your fly wide door. You've got your fly screen.
You got to get your deadlocks on.
Yeah, put your deadlocks on, and often the glass goes with it. And you know, right. I mean, it's a slightly mess that has to be tidied up, and that can take some time before you even get a chance to, you know, peel
the glazes in and putty, and it's a nightmare.
7 News with Yvonne Kenny.
Olympians, we salute you. Eric, we love you so. Urs Bogler, we adore you. Kegs, you gave us a show. Oh, Marius, we'll never forget you. Mallet, the loveliest I've seen. Hello to Wang and all the boys from everyone at the Dream. Fatso, we love you so. Fatso, we love you so.
Interviews just come off the wires from France, featuring Madame Hort.
Mary Jo.
Yes. Roy, let's cross over to see Paris and see what...
See what she had to say.
Ms. Perec had to say.
Je regrette.
I have regrets.
Je regrette pour eux.
I regret Sydney.
Mais j'ai encore beaucoup plus de regrets que, que tous les gens qui attendaient quelque chose.
Dickhead.
Parce qu'encore une fois,
I've been a dickhead.
J'ai tellement donné pour en arriver là.
Most
et
of my life.
Je viens de tellement loin.
But especially in Sydney.
Que les gens y comprennent.
I apologize to the people of Sydney.
Que quel que soit, quel
Very
que soit
much
le résultat.
For being a dickhead.
Quel que soit ce que j'aurais fait.
I'll try not to be a dickhead.
Pour moi, c'était. Pour moi, c'était
anymore.
Une grande victoire.
Yes. She went on to say that I was a goose when I was in Sydney, and this overtook my whole, you know, my whole appearance and demeanour there. I can't quite translate the French there. I'm going to give up running. I'm going to retire to a Thai monastery. I'm never going to talk again. And I apologise to everybody who's been associated with me throughout my whole life. I'm sorry I've caused so much distress to people who run all over the world, because I bought the craft of running
down
into ill repute. I've been ill repute. I've been an idiot to myself, to my family, to my spikes, to my running shorts, to my running top, to my hairdresser, and I'm going to go into the room of mirrors and have a bloody good hard look at myself, you know?
No.
Have I No, so, I think you translated that accurately?
No, that's pretty accurate, HG. That's pretty accurate. She went on to say, I think that as well she added that she's been an embarrassment to the whole French nation from the period, every French person born since the time of Louis the First. Right. That is going back.
She then went on to apologise to Brigitte Bardot, Gérard Depardieu, the brilliant British racket Henri Lecomte. Catherine Deneuve, even Blastic Bertrand, the Belgian bloke, got into the act.
François Lecomte.
She apologised to Je suis un Roxar, Bill Wyman.
Jacques Lecomte.
Jacques French Canadian, but be that as it may, she encompassed them all.
To the shape of the croissant. The shape of the croissant. To those big, stupid bowls of coffee.
Yes. She believes the croissant should be flat and square, not in a.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Anyway, that was how it went.
Yeah, no, she went on, didn't she?
Baguette.
She really opened up. Baguette, she embarrassed baguettes.
Fromage.
She'll never eat baguette again. Soft ripened cheese is just ordinary in France.
Yes.
Our wine, she said French wines are now the worst in the world.
Yeah. Well, she covered the lot, didn't she? And, in fact, she went on to say the French basketball team, which had a big win tonight...
Were gooses.
And the French tilt in Sydney should powder and pack up and go home before it causes any more embarrassment.
That's right.
God, she got around.
She did go on, didn't she?
Yeah, she
really let it fly. Opened up like a can of worms.
That's right.
Yes, hello everyone. Welcome to Darling Harbour, 54 kilogram, the bantamweight class semi-final. We pick up the fight in the break in round three. That's where we are now. In the red, on screen now, Claren Vincent from the United States up against Guillermo Rigondo from Cuba in blue. And once again, we're joined ringside by Aussie Joe Bugner, senior seven commentator. At the moment, the Cubans 7-3 up. And we move on into the third now, well underway. And what a fight it's been so far, Roy.
It's been a terrific fight, hasn't it, HG? But Rigondo, bloody hell, he's quick on his feet. He's an extraordinary fighter, showing all the skills here this afternoon. I don't know what Vincent can do to pick it up, but I've never seen a bloke this quick on his feet before. And I don't know if Joe has any thoughts in the matter. I mean, you might do. Joe?
Yes, that Rigondo just too quick on his feet.
Yeah.
As soon as Clarence sets himself, he's on the move.
Ooh.
And we've got a knockdown now with those thoughts coming from senior boxing commentator Joe.
Yes, I wouldn't get too excited about that.
Oh, okay.
Try not to. We'll keep our hats on as we move on now with the Cuban well out in front. It's a bit of a clinic in round three at the moment with Vincent in red from the United States having to do all the work to stay in it. And I think that, Roy, if we can get Joe's thoughts on this next passage, I think we'll be able to get a clearer idea of where this fight's going.
Yes, of course, you know, if we'd had the old way, where they were going three-minute rounds.
Ah.
The last minute in the round will certainly pull some energy out of these fighters.
This
is where a lot of fitness depended on in the old days. But, of course, now it's four two-minute rounds. They can sail through it if they're very fit, and sometimes could be against them in some ways, like in Clarence Vincent's at this stage.
Well, it's incredibly insightful from Seven senior boxing commentator Aussie Joe Bugner. And Roy, as we see now, standing count applied to Vincent, it doesn't look as though he can get back into the bout.
I don't think so, Aussie. I don't think he's got the punch. I don't think he's got the power. He hasn't got any of the skills for mine.
And Rigondo is a big bloke in the 54-kilogram class here, taking on a much smaller component and really giving it up.
Whoa!
Knocked him over again.
Put him on his pants.
Indeed. Down on his pants, and gave him his calling cards and said, have a read of that when you come to, bro.
That was a wonderful punch, wasn't it?
It was indeed. So the Cuban...
I mean, that's what we like seeing, isn't it? That's what gets people in. Wonderful, clean punches like that and a bloke on his ass.
That's right. Greeting cards. That's what people like to see. Messages sent through the post. The Cuban, another flurry of punches here. Hangs on to Vincent. And, of course, the referee pulls him apart, as he quite wisely does there. And now that's the end of that round. And
I wonder what he's got to do. I don't know if Joe's got any thoughts about what we can expect from Rigondo in the next round.
Yes, what tactics, Joe?
Joe, wake up, bud.
Yes, he doesn't have to do anything. They just virtually dance away, throw a few punches, just to give the judges a bit of a look in. Yes, this young fella is definitely going for gold.
Right.
Yes, Joe, thinking of everybody there with his comment about the judges having to do something.
I hadn't thought of that.
No, I thought the judges could not off. Cuba up 16, Rigondo and Vincent only 6. And he's got to lift his game here as we get into the fourth round now with about 30 seconds to go by the clock. And Roy...
He's got to go for a knockout, hasn't he?
I mean,
that's all he can do. All he can do is sit the Cuban on his date, knocked out.
Indeed, that's right. We need a big punch here. But he's wily. The Cuban dancing away from the American... American as we get into the dying moments of this particular bout. And I think that you can
He's toying with him now.
The bout down to Rigondo from Cuba, who will then now go on to the gold medal round as he dances away. And the little Vincent has to chase him around and make himself look like a goose. Roy?
Well, that's it. I think the Cubans walked away with it. Far too classy, too many skills. And the American, although he's going pro, I just don't know if he's going to be able to get anywhere. Joe, have you got any thoughts on what Clarence can do? Joe?
Yes, Clarence just did not have any answers.
That's right.
Rigondo from Cuba was definitely just too talented. There's no question about it. He seems much, much bigger than
that's what you said, Jason.
Clarence from the United States in the red corner.
Yeah.
Joe's having a good day, isn't he?
No, he's having a great day.
I've never seen him so relaxed ringside, you know, as the fighters.
He's quiet, isn't he?
Very quiet as a bloody mouse down there ringside. Joe, you there? And what do you think's going to happen? This kid from the Cuba. Can he go on?
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of talent in that young fella. 20 years of age on Sunday.
That's right. Yeah, what a birthday present that's going to be.
Gold
medal.
Yesterday, Jake Tarima did very well in the long jump. He bagged a silver medal and took me back many, many years to the great days when Gary Honey used
to
make the
leap.
Gary Honey used to make the leap into the sand. Jay's described as a wild child. You know, he has that time to fly, Jai, that sort of gear, you know, jump and Jai.
Jump
that
and Jai? I've heard jump and Jai.
Time to fly, Jai. Impulse Airlines, etc. What I was going to say...
Is he a sort of Cool Hand Luke type?
I think he might be a Cool Hand Luke type, but what I was going to say is how wild is he? I mean, how... You know, he obviously often has a cheroot trackside, you know, stubs it out and that makes
wild.
A jump.
He's wild. He's a hard-drinking, hard-smoking, hard-rocking, hard-hitting dude.
Yeah?
He's a rootin', tootin', shootin', jumpin', jivin', jive.
Yeah, well, I was going to say centimetre machine.
Centimetre machine,
yeah.
That's
just
nice.
Just something off the top of my head.
That's not bad.
Yeah, and when he does this at the top of the...
I love that.
I know, I think...
I love that.
You know what I'm thinking?
What are you thinking, Len?
I'm thinking either two things. He's got to jump that much further than his last jump.
Yeah.
Or I've got this much downstairs.
Yeah.
You know, I can't work out which it is.
Seven News with Sam Riley.
Did you see any performances where you thought, well, I could have done better than that?
That's right.
You know, Mary Jo Perrex style. Did you think, I could have won that.
Go home.
Yeah. Now, look, people have suggested to us that so as you can get a contrast between, you know, ordinariness and brilliance, that one lane in every race should be left for people out of the stand. Mm. Now, you'd be a wonderful person to have up in the stands.
Yes.
Just ready to sort of come down, get in the cozzies and off you go in lane nine, as we'd call it. Be terrific. I reckon you bring home gold every so often. Roy just reminded me that we haven't been saying g'day all that much this week, and I just hope people who may be thinking of packing up and leaving the Sydney Olympics, and probably people do have homes to go to after a magical fortnight here, remember to, when you get home, surprise them all in Antwerp or Dusseldorf or Hamburg or Milwaukee.
Helsinki.
Mexico.
Rome. Sorry.
Vladivostok, you know, Bern, you know, Lucerne. By walking in and saying, putting down the bags and saying, g'day.
Yeah.
And imagine the people lighting up at home with bemusement as where's this person been and why are they saying g'day to me? Because that's the only way the Australian way will get out of here. It's by people coming here, seeing how bloody marvellous it is and going home and saying g'day.
G'day. G'day.
And we shouldn't... I mean, I have been complacent, Roy.
Yes, I know we both have. We've been remiss.
Yes, I've been complacent.
Mind you, we've sort of got over the hump of g'day now. We're getting pretty close to bugger off.
Yes, hello everyone and welcome to Horsley Park for the dressage, individual dressage today. And we've got Anki van Grunsven from the Netherlands out there on Big Gouda's. Roy, the horse is handling it beautifully, but I know you and I have spent a lot of time trying to make Rooting King do these sort of things. What is the skill that Big Gouda's has been learning here?
Actually, to train a horse like this, of course this goes back to, I think it was Louis the 15th, who started this idea of training horses to do basically absurd and meaningless things. This horse, Big Gouda's, would have been probably attacked with a ball-peen hammer to begin with as a foal. Would have had electrodes tied to, attached to every movable joint when it was 3 or 4 weeks old, I suppose. And any false move made, it would have been given, you know, just to begin with, maybe 50, 60, 70 volts, leading up to maybe 600 volts. I mean, my experience has always been that if you give a horse 600 or 700 volts more than 1,000 times a day, it dies. So you've got to be very careful.
Right. You've got to keep tabs on how many times you press the on button.
Oh, yeah. But by the same token, you can't let it go silly. I mean, if it gets away on you. Yeah, if it gets away on you, you're finished.
But are you giving it messages to raise the front feet in the manner that it's doing here?
It starts off as an accident. You know, it'll struggle to do something like walk. And if it does the right thing, it's fine. If it does something wrong, zap!
Right.
You're in there. And zap. Now, this horse, Big Gouda's, I think it's now a 12-year-old, it probably would have been zapped upwards of 900,000 times in its life. Because you've got to apply the electrodes as soon as Anki's finished with it, she'll get the electrodes back on it because you don't want it to get ideas.
Roy, do you try and work with rewards at all as we see Big Goudas going around in a very small circle?
Yeah.
You know, like say a Mars bar or a Cherry Ripe or a Choo Choo bar or you know maybe a Minty or a Fantail when it gets something right accidentally.
Yeah, HG, I've seen he's not a nice bit of froth coming out of the mouth there, HG. You'll have to bloody get to work on that. Can I suggest a couple of electrodes in the mouth? Which, you know, obviously a coach will be working on there. Look at that, that's unsightly. I hate a horse when it does that. To get back to your question, HG, people have tried this. It was an American technique for some time to use more carrot than stick. It never works because they take advantage of it after a while. You know, horses aren't stupid. They're cunning. They're cunning. And you can
Does Big Gouda's like doing this, though, Roy? Or does it only do this because it's fearing of the shock?
It's the fearing of the shock.
Yeah.
It's the fearing of the shock. You know, a lot of people have said over the years that, you know, it's cruel. Mm. It's cruel. And I suppose it is if you're too anthropomorphic about it. But you've got to remember it's just a beast. You know, it's an animal.
It's Big Gouda's.
You know, it's not a sentient being. I mean, it doesn't vote, make decisions.
No.
It has no choice
in
the matter.
Television.
No.
Yes.
And that's it. And Anki's done a terrific job. She's just got to work on that froth in the mouth.
And it will be a great performance.
Yeah.
Roy, does she control it with the buttocks at all by pressing down on a switch device, battery style?
I don't think, strictly speaking, that's lawful. But I think the IOC is looking into that as a way of getting the stands up even higher.
And now this is an enormous thrill to welcome the silver medalist in the 100 metres and the bronze medalist in the 200 metres. Can you put your hands together for Anno Bolden?
Yes, yes.
Anno, when I was being coached with my running, we used to see the 100 metres basically as 45 steps. Get those 45 steps done as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
And with the 200 metres, I used to see it as 90 steps and get the 90 steps over with as quickly as bloody possible. Is that basically how you work? Is that the technique you use?
I've heard that somewhere before.
Yes.
45 and a half steps is about what it takes for a world-class runner to run the 100 meters correctly in 9.998, and that's that's what we aim for. If we can run the fewer steps you take, obviously, the shorter the time.
Now, shoes. Shoes. There's enormous pressure on shoes.
Yeah.
And shoes, and in fact, you know, on breakthroughs in shoes, do you think it's overstated slightly the possibility that you could actually get 0.001 of a second out of a better sort of shoe? Where are we at with that?
I think that for the most part, if you put an 11 flat sprinter in the most technologically advanced shoe, he's going to lose to the barefoot 10 flat sprinter.
How do you reckon you'd go in a pair like this? These are the most technologically advanced shoe made in Australia.
Yeah.
We believe it will give you a guaranteed 0.2 better time. Mm. 0.2. Just feel how light they are.
Yeah.
And they're incredibly light. Yeah. They're just incredible.
Yeah,
and they look good.
They couldn't be any worse than last night. So, you know, I wish you guys would have gave these to me earlier.
Just changing the subject for a moment. You know Mary Jo Perrick. she's come out saying that she could have beaten Kathy. Now, I think that's rubbish. Do you think that's rubbish?
Yeah. Yeah,
that's
I do.
Rubbish.
I do.
Yeah. Athens. Yeah, isn't that brilliant? Isn't that brilliant? And what's more, they can do the Olympic rings as well.
That's right.
And they've got a version of the hammer throw that'll defy description.
And wood chopping.
Wood chopping. Yeah, wood chopping as well. Isn't that amazing? Wallace is a writer, New York Post. He's written an article this week which has shocked me. He says basically Australians don't like Americans. I think that's the tenor of his thesis. I find it hard to imagine, and as you can hear from the audience groan.
Groaning disbelief.
Groaning disbelief, yes. Could this be true, Roy?
I find it very hard to believe, HG, when it comes. Look. Australians, New Zealanders, and Americans are friends under the one umbrella of ANZUS.
Yes, people forget that.
The ANZUS Pact. We've been in the trenches together over the years. We're very, very good friends. The best friends we have in the world are the New Zealanders and the Americans. But actually, I always say friendship comes at a cost.
Yes.
Yeah. And that cost is honesty.
Yeah.
You've got to be honest to be a true friend. Yeah. And I, while individually Americans are very, enjoyable people, modest people, quite lovely people. We've met lovely Americans. Individually, they're very fine. Yeah. It's just en masse, one can be slightly, I think, critical. They are loud. Yeah. Ignorant, self-obsessed, to the point of narcissism. They are inward-looking, barren, uninteresting, and incapable of seeing any of these qualities that so puts the world against them wherever they go. They wonder why they are so disliked. It's just they can't see it. And that is their major stupidity. That is the fatal flaw of Americans. Individually, they're wonderful people. Wonderful. It's just in toto. I mean, get any more than two.
It's all down.
And I'm sorry.
Ladies and gentlemen, can you welcome from the United States athletics team, John Drummond and Lawrence Johnson? I bet you do it once more before he goes.
Yeah. Do you? I noticed with people who leap the bar hate that bloody bar. Do you hate distance or do you hate time?
I hate distance.
You hate distance.
I can't control time. There's no control over time, but I hate distance.
And Lawrence, do you hate the bar?
Days like today, I hate the bar.
You hate the bar.
I hate the bar.
But you think in hate when you're about to go, when you're about to unleash down. You thinking I hate that?
There's a lot of things you're thinking. You know, I wanted to get you all caught up on a few pole vaulting terms, so next time you kind of commentate and you can kind of add some of those things in.
Please.
For instance,
please.
We have one that's a lot of these techniques. Some of them you've seen here in Sydney. Some of them a little hard, so you haven't quite seen all of them. Like pick the berries. You know, when you come running down there in the runway, you play at the pole, you get up over the top of the pole, and you sit on the top of the pole as you're going into the pit. That's called picking the berries. Now, if you make a mistake, it's called stabbing the gopher. That doesn't feel too much. You got to be careful with that. You got to really watch for the pros. So, you know. Is that there?
I love it.
Is that there?
I want to take that home.
But Lawrence, how many berries would you pick?
You know, I think if you have any more than a couple berries to pick, I think you're probably in some kind of trouble. Yeah. You might be in the wrong event. You might want to check another profession or something.
We were talking a little bit earlier on in the program. We were reacting to an article written by Wallace Matthews, an American journalist, who suggested that Americans are hated by Australians. And yet, when you arrived tonight, you were saying what a terrific time you were having and how much loved you felt. Now, what's going on here? Who's right?
Well, I'll say this in much respects to all the volunteers and all the people who gave up their time here. I would say we have had the warmest reception that I've ever experienced. I was in Atlanta in 96, and I mean, you know, America, they treated us beautifully, but I think the fact that you guys don't take yourself so serious and you guys are so laid back,
definitely.
Help us enjoy ourselves. And I'll say this, if it wasn't for this show, I'd probably be the gold medalist. Because I sat up so many nights and watched it and laughed.
It's your fault.
I gotta blame somebody. You're the blame. But I'm telling you, you guys are awesome.
Yeah.
And I'm serious, man. I mean, you guys help the athletes. I'm sure athletes all over the village that are watching this are saying to themselves, if it wasn't for you guys allowing us to not take ourselves so serious, because we expend so much energy, mental energy, not the physical, because that's what we do, but so much mental. We needed a comic relief, and you guys have been there for us.
Look, we promise not to come to Athens, so you'll be able to get gold. And, look, thanks very much for coming in this evening, and on behalf of everybody connected with the Dream, we'd like you to get your hands on these fabulous mementos of your time in Sydney.
I wanted this more than the gold medal.
And now we see a chance for them to clinch it here.
Cameron. This is golden glory.
In it goes. There it is. Fantastic result for Cameroon. And the celebrations, I understand, haven't even stopped and aren't likely to stop in Cameroon for a month and a half. Roy? No.
Well, I think they're getting their information via NBC, HG, so I don't think they're going to find out that they've won the gold for another...
3 weeks.
For another week or so.
The silver medal winning Opals. Can you welcome Lauren Jackson and Michelle Tim?
It did appear to get a little bit personal. Is it Lisa Leslie? Did it get a little bit personal between you two? It looked as if it was.
Well, I didn't think it was personal, but I think she might have.
Yeah, well, she was doing a lot of talking, and you seem to be copying things pretty much on the chin, but she seemed to want to get me a bit more aggressive about it.
She got much more aggressive when I accidentally pulled her hair out.
Yes.
No.
That can happen.
But Laz wasn't to know that she was wearing a hairpiece.
You just got caught in it and it came out. I was like, oh my God, what is that?
It ended up on the base of it. It was like a dead rat. Like, shit. It was the funniest thing you've ever seen.
Well, she didn't like that by the looks of things.
No.
She looked, as they'd say, mightily pissed.
She was pretty upset. Running down the court, like getting obscenities yelled at me, it was really quite
and
nice.
Trying to get what was left of her head together. That was a tough thing for her because there wasn't much hair left, and she had to try and scrunch it all in this little thing. So it was probably the highlight of the game, actually. it wasn't too many highlights to see, but that was phenomenal. Like everyone, the whole stadium's like going, you.
7 News with Melinda Gainsford Taylor.
Beat Marion Jones in a race. Now, you're getting the T-shirt printed up, and she was running flat out, wasn't she? Faster than she normally runs.
I would love to say that.
You could see her obviously slowing up, and you knew you could take her, and so you thought, bloody hell, here's my chance, I'm going to get it.
Actually, I did. It was really quite interesting, because, you know, I'm coming up there, and I think, yep, she's slowing down. I'm thinking, there's 110,000 people. Should I do it? Why the hell not? So I did.
And is she an intimidating presence when you're getting ready to go out and...
Oh, not particularly. She's actually a really fantastic person. Yeah. She's got a, you know, great composure, and she's, you know, she's very friendly, which is always great. But I, you know, love racing against her. It's, you know, it's wonderful fun. And
so you'd feel as if you've made friends? Have you made friends with...
She says, hello, Mel. That's
pretty exciting. Hey! Yeah. Right, we're doing that. Give me chips and that. Hamburger. Hello, Mel. You look very enjoying.
I'm writing about the issue of Dick Pound.
What?
He says, I don't have anything to say about Dick Pound, but I know you guys love saying Dick Pound so much that I have a good chance of having my email read on air if I use the name Dick Pound a lot.
Yes, and now in the final dream for the 27th Olympiad, can you please welcome Ian Thorpe?
So it's a party at the moment over at the village?
Yeah.
It is. Yes,
for those that are finished and those that aren't finished are a bit annoyed about it.
Well, it must be hard for them, mustn't it?
It is hard because, you know, everyone's enjoying themselves. Enjoying competition. You know, we've got one more day of this and I think everyone's going to be making the most of it because this isn't going to happen again.
And is Richo reading out the riot act to people over there? Is he getting them settled down? You haven't seen him, have you?
Yeah.
He's done nothing. This reinforces
the word
our position.
Down.
No, on the loudspeaker at night, you know. Ram 22, could you turn out the lights and settle down, please? Bulgaria, stop doing what you're doing right now. And then in the morning, he asked Bulgaria to come into the office, and he'll always say, you know, there's one lot that spoil it for everyone else, isn't it? And you're it.
Did I read that you're off to America to have a look at the Guggenheim Museum and this sort of stuff? Galleries and what have you?
No, I'm not going to look at art. I'm going.
Why aren't you
going
to have a look at some art?
No. I've got other things that I've got planned. I've got an appearance there I'm doing with Giorgio Armani there.
Ah, yeah, are you going to be modelling gear?
No, no.
Well, what are you going to do then?
I'm a swimmer, mate. That's all I'm doing.
Well, this has been the best week for me because I've got to meet, like, so many famous people. And I've been standing on the corner down there for the week, like, just holding up this sign. And I've got this drink bottle from a guy called Chris Unthank, which is an Australian steeplechase person. And I got a scrapbook. And then I went there my tickets for the softball, and I bought a softball. The local paper I'm in, on page 9, it's just saying that I was on the corner and I'm from George's Hall and all that. Well, it's been excellent because you've met so many cyclists from all over the world, and I'm really proud that we had it here.
So, yeah, it's been fantastic. It's been a cultural uplifting experience for us out here at Horsley Park. Probably the good times here that we've had. It's just been one party night after another. It seems to be like a 16-day piss-up with a little bit of horse riding in between.
I must say, we said on day one of the Dream Day One, that these were the greatest games ever, and nothing in the intervening time, in the intervening fortnight, has given me one moment's pause to reconsider that evaluation.
No,
the greatest games ever, ladies and gentlemen.
You're right.
I mean, sure, go back to Antwerp, trace the line through. Sure, there was a good
thing. It was a great game. Antwerp was a beauty.
It was a fantastic game.
A beauty. Fantastic.
Yeah. So magnificent.
You know, read so much about it.
So cracker. Oh, cracker. 56 in Melbourne, a really big high point. A really big high point. And now, topping it all off, we've climbed that Everest again in games presentation, in friendliness, in the best volunteers in the world, ladies and gentlemen. Best volunteers in the world.
You're right. You're right. If Melbourne was the top of Everest, and I think it was, what we've done is lugged a few bags of concrete and some bricks to the top of Everest and stacked up the bricks and stood on it.
Yes, that's right.
The sublime view.
And if people think of the catchphrase of the Sydney Games as throwing down a gauntlet,
Well, I think tonight we can throw down the gauntlet for the rest of the games in eternity right here like that and say, do your best, but it'll have to be bloody good bloody to beat good. What we've turned on.
Oh, yes.
Here's Ollie up on high on the tower. Haven't seen much of Ollie during the games.
Oh, very poor landing. It was not well executed at all. And the somersault started. Beautiful rotation, but there's a twist on the way down. And flat on the back. See there, the twist on the way down. No, very poor entry. Very little splash.
And the scores here remarkably high from the AOC. The volunteers and the foreigners and the NBC didn't rate it much at all. Here's Millie, looking confident, has been diving well.
Yes, a lovely swimming costume. Oh, the inward rotation. It was a pretty good effort, but once again, make a huge mistake on entry. Looking for the big splash, but there was just hardly any splash at all. So a disappointing dive for Millie.
Well, the New Zealander, NBC and the IOC rated it just an ordinary dive, and once again the AOC remarkable with their high scores. Dickhead. What a diver. And Dickhead about to give his best at the Olympics.
Oh, incredible reverse rotation. But you'll see in slow motion he has landed on his Jets crackers. That has to be painful.
Well, he just hasn't nailed that one at all. But once again, the AOC have gone very high on the scores and the others didn't like it much at all. Disappointing for Dickhead. The boxing kangaroo about to punch out a big one.
What an incredible fast spin. But I cannot believe the errors on entry. Now, remember, we're looking for a huge splash on entry. Quick rotation, but faltering as they hit the water. You can see there, very soft landing. Just not good enough.
Well, the IOC didn't like it much. Australia, volunteers, no good at all. The AOC again have gone big. Fatso, the Australian hero. The wombat who's been everywhere at these games and killing them. Here he goes with his 10-metre bomb.
Oh, sensational entry from Fatso. That ass wombat has nailed his entry and straight to the bottom of the pool. Oh, very impressive diving from Fatso. Look at that for a landing and the fat ass pointing back to where he came from. Great slow motion shot of the fat ass and what a landing.
Steve, I can't believe that. The others couldn't even break the surface, but his rip entry just got him there.
Well, that's the advantage of having a fat ass, and it paid dividends here on the entry. He took a risk, but he's nailed that dive, and it could be the gold medal dive.
Let's have a look at the scores now, and right across the board, perfect tens, great scoring, except the AOC again couldn't find a score. Nil from the AOC, and even 9.5 from the New Zealand judge. But as far as the crowd is concerned, here's the winner. Fatso emerges, clearly the gold medalist and the hero of the public here at Sydney 2000. Well done to Fatso, the bomb king of Sydney.
The Prime Minister standing on his feet, as he should.
Just a couple of quick medal tallies here, HG. I thought we should compare ourselves with Canada very quickly.
Yes.
Because Canada is a country of similar size and number of people and economic well-being. Canada got 2 golds, 2 silvers and 8 bronze for a total of 12. And we have a total of 56. So yes.
I wouldn't dwell on that comparison, Roy.
So, with our tally, HG, it's called Come on Athens, I believe, or Towards Athens. These don't take into account a possible bronze by the Boomers tomorrow, I should point out. Yes. In Seoul in 1988, we had 14 medals. In Barcelona in 1992, we had 27, which is 13 more than Seoul. In Atlanta in 1996, we got 41, which is 14 more than Barcelona. In Sydney, 56, which is 15 more than in Atlanta, or the toilet. So if this trend continues, we'll get 16 more medals in Athens and in Sydney, which bring our tally to Athens 2004, 72 medals.
That's fantastic. And
And finally, Roy, it's been tremendous to pack down under the doona every night with you here.
Oh, it's been great.
Between 11 and 1 or whenever Sandy let it, and Bruce let us on. And finally, of course, we come to Bronze in the Hearts of Gold. Bronze in the Hearts of Gold, it's, let's see, Endless Beginnings is the song. Yeah. It's the SOCOG choir with IOC augmentation. It's the Dream Choir headed up tonight by Mr. John Farnham and friends, and the immortal reading of Go You Good Thing. In you come, John. See you later, Australia.
Here we are.
Farewell from the dream.
The pain it takes, the yearning longs, day after day. Now's the time to draw the pain.
Been a showcase for Aussie musical talent.
Showcase.
Yeah, showcase. Wait a minute. Wait till she finishes.
Oh, yeah. Hi, Bolivia!
I'm The Dream has been a showcase for Aussie musical talent to throw down the
gauntlet
to the rest of the world. Thanks very much, Chase. He gets both in. With such a depth of talent, showing night after night, the world's music industry must be beating a path to Sydney. Who needs Barry White when you've got such hits as We Can Do It Again and Go You Good Thing?
Go, you good thing.
Put
go,
a cap
go, go, you good thing.
In fact, what does Michael Jackson's Thriller that the Dream's Hearts of Gold doesn't have?
Hello, Bolivia! Very short one here, HG. This comes from someone described as Fatso Lover.
Fatso Lover?
Fatso's Lover, sorry.
Fatso's Lover.
Fatso's Lover in Brisbane. And Fatso's Lover says, message, I find Fatso the big-assed wombat disturbingly arousing. I wonder why. That's a beautiful thing about Fatso, HG. He does celebrate humanity.
Yes. Romance is on the air. Imagine pulling back the sheets, the bump in the bed. The butler's prince!
And yes. Have you fallen in love?
I have. That the wombat is very attractive.
Yes. Very attractive, yes.
It's a shy little man with a very, very big ass. Yes. Yeah, I know. It's good luck to kiss the ass of Fatso.
Yeah. Saves you kissing ass elsewhere, you might be pleased to know.
It's the pheromones, it's the atmosphere, it's the movement of seminiferous tubules.
That's the butler's prince.
The butler's
just
prince.
Leave him alone and enjoy him. When you see him on television, etc., 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 but there's no reason to take him home.
Fatso should have a chance to make the Olympics.
It doesn't matter what nationality you are, you just see the little guy and you just open up and want to be friendly.
Voilà, c'est Fatso, the fat-assed wombat.
Questo è Fatso.
Det är helt ute. Alla digger Fatso.
Fatso, it's as your son. Tämä on wombat.
Fatso hat. Fatso ist ein liebes Kerlchen. Ich bin ja auch so, wenn man sich so ganz mal guckt, dann rein hier so.